continuation of the Board of Selectmen meeting for Tuesday, November 22nd, 2016. Next up will be the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Get your mics all good? Okay, so as always, we begin our meeting, our public portion of our meeting. Well, let me back up. We did have an executive session this evening. We went into executive session for several matters, most specifically to discuss strategies with respect to collective bargaining updates or get updates regarding collective bargaining from relative to the town manager or relative to the police, fire, and dispatch unions from the town manager. And also to discuss strategies in preparation for contract negotiations with the police chief, because an open meeting law may have a detrimental effect on the negotiating position of the board. So with that, and coming out of executive session, I'd like to make two quick announcements. The Board of Selectmen has voted to provide a merit increase of 3.25% for the town manager for FY17, and the Board of Selectmen has voted to provide a 3.25% merit increase to the police chief for FY17. I'd also like to take, before we have our guests join us, if there's anybody here, which I believe there are, for public comment, to do a quick readout from the Woodville Rod and Gun Club, if I could please. The Woodville Rod and Gun Club is presenting their annual community Thanksgiving dinner free of charge Thanksgiving Day from 12 to 3 p.m. All are welcome, and the more the merrier. To sign up, please contact the Senior Center. Transportation is available upon request. Mary McLeod, retired Hopkinton Senior Center Outreach Supervisor, Hopkinton Cable TV show, Senior View, for 23 years, is the 2016 recipient of the Michael J. Preet Award at the annual HCAM TV meeting. This award is presented to an individual in recognition of community service and dedication to Hopkinton television stations. And finally, the Senior Center now has an excellent assistive hearing system for those with hearing difficulty. Is that the right word?
Assistive.
Assistive? If anyone has felt unable to attend programs in the past, the system will give you the freedom to participate. The quality is extremely good, and we're very impressed with it. The system was purchased with a 75% from Mass Councils on Aging and 25% from the Friends of Hopkinton Seniors. So those are three announcements coming out of the Senior Center. If anybody has any questions, feel free to, I can repeat anything. Okay, so with that, we'll now go to the public forum session segment of our meeting. And I'll invite any guests that want to join us to come to the guest table and share their thoughts on their town or their town. Please, Mr. Richardson.
Board of Selectmen,
thank you.
I know you probably have already seen these.
I've got it. It's right here.
Thank you.
I'm pleased to distribute the long-awaited business brochure guide, if you will, that the Chamber and the town has been working on for about 8 months now. This is a concept that Chamber around discussed and said, well, we really need a printed brochure anymore. Everything's electronic. Do people really want this? And so in looking at other towns that have collateral material, when you go to other events, whether they're community events, whether it's a combined chamber event at other chambers, we seem to be lacking in that respect. So through the efforts of Erica Brown writing, Anna Ivanoff and graphic layout of the product, and again, many guys, Norman, Elaine, board members, the board of directors members, we have proudly produced this document that we feel tells a lot about the town, what a great place it is to live, work, and play in, and we will continue to update this on an ongoing basis electronically. There's a link on the chamber website, as well as now on the town website, to this document, and again, any suggestions, recommendations, for improvements, we would look for those as well. Again, every chamber member gets 50 copies as part of their MIP, and we look forward to, again, seeing these distributed throughout the town and getting some feedback on how we can make it better.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Scott. I think it's awesome. I've seen this sort of in draft form. This is the time I'm seeing the final copy here. It looks awesome. I think it makes the town of Hopkinton look more awesome every time I look at it. So it's really nicely done, and I think it'll be very well received, not only within Hopkinton, but certainly outside of Hopkinton. People consider living here, working here, investing here, etc. I think it's just a great piece, and we really appreciate it. Thank you.
You're welcome. And again, thank you, Norman's office and the town hall, for really working with us on this. It was a partnership through the 2020 committee on the chamber to really get a piece of a document that tells a story.
Great. Awesome. Thanks so much. Very good.
There are lots of these available. So again, I'll leave another box here. And again, if you need more, please, you know where to reach me.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Scott. Pulls it together nice, doesn't it? Yeah. Okay, any other guests who would like to join us this evening to say hello? Good evening. If you can state your name and address for our friends at home watching.
My name is Stephen Benford. My family has lived on this road for almost 14 years.
Hello, Stephen.
My son, David. My wife, Amy, is over here. I am co-founder executive director of the Keep Smiling for Abby Foundation, Hopkinton-based charity that's committed to stopping anaphylaxis. The foundation was founded in January 2014, about a month after daughter Abby died from an anaphylactic reaction to food. Abby had a lifelong history of anaphylaxis. We managed that within our home, with our friends, family, community, Little League coaches, softball coaches, school administrators, the whole thing. On December 14th, 2013, had an anaphylactic reaction in our home. Despite a textbook emergency response from our family as well as Hopkinton EMS, it took 6 minutes for them to get to our home. She suffered injuries that were fatal. She passed away on December 18th, 2013. My family benefited tremendously from the amazing town we have here. The community supported us in an incredible way for months, kept us on our feet. About a month later, we started the foundation. Our goals are to fund research, increase awareness of the severity of anaphylaxis, and fund scholarships here in Hopkinton. We're partnered with the Lewis Institute at Harvard University. We are funding a project called Project Abby. The foundation has donated over $100,000, so they will be by the end of the year here, to Project Abby at the Wyss Institute. We raise money through fundraising, direct fundraising efforts. We have in August every year, a field hockey event. The chairman has played there. We invite everyone here, all the leaders of the town, in our field hockey event in August. It's a lot of fun. We also have had three bibs in the marathon in the last 2 years. We've raised over $20 of those two bibs. It's a big part of our fundraising. We have applied for 5 bibs through the town process. I'm here tonight to tell you a little bit about our future and the good work we're doing, and appeal for 5 bibs to be. We've also started 2 scholarships at Hopkinton High School. They've awarded 6 scholarships and almost $10,000. Just a little side note, I wanted to talk a little bit about research we're funding. The research we're funding is an anaphylactic detection and treatment device. The device is intended to measure biochemical and physiological symptoms of anaphylaxis, alert the patient of an anaphylactic event, and treat the patient with an epinephrine dose. The Wyss Institute, in just a short year of research, has advanced the sensitivity of histamine by a factor of 1,000. They've created a predictive algorithm that can detect respiratory failure and alert the patient. We believe that there's several addressable markets for this technology, including the 15 million Americans who are at risk of. They wear the device on their bodies. We also think there's clinical application in asthma as well as allergy treatment. And most interesting, this week we learned that up to 25% of cancer patients suffer anaphylaxis in the treatment of their medicine course. It's intended to save them, actually makes them sick and could kill them. So we think there's a huge opportunity to save lives, and we're doing our best to make a difference and look for your support in our fundraising bid for BIBS. I think that's all I have, Mr. Chairman. I want to say thank you, and I want to wish everybody a happy Thanksgiving.
Stephen, thank you for coming tonight. Out of Hockington, Mrs. Abbey, and anything we can do to support and honor her memory, we will do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate that, Brian.
Okay. Excuse me. Next up is the consent agenda. We have one, two, three items. The third item to include gifts to the town. Does anybody want to break out any of the consent agenda items, please? Mr. Catino, all set? All set? I think we should break out item number one, if we could, please. We have it here this evening, and I think it would be appropriate for the community to say hello. I'm good with leaving items two and three together, but I'd like to just acknowledge that one of the gifts we received this year, or this for this meeting this evening, was from the Hawthorne Retirement Group, LLC, who is the owner of Fairview Estates Retirement Living, the new development down on East Main Street. The gift was made to the town because Mrs. Wright was gracious enough to attend their grand opening and represent the town. And so they've asked that the $100 gift go towards the town's ambulance fund. So we'd want that in the motion that include going to the ambulance fund. So the chair will entertain a motion to approve items two and three on the consent agenda.
So four. And four?
Two, three, and four. I'm sorry, I missed number four. Everybody good with number four, too? Okay. So the chair will entertain a motion to approve items two, three, and four on the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Item number one. Veda Kerr is before us, is going to come before us this evening, if she would. Veda, if you wouldn't mind joining us at the guest table. And as a candidate to become a member of the Board of Registrars of Voters as nominated by the Hopkinton Republican Town Committee for a term to expire on February 1st, 2019 or until a successor is appointed. So with that, Veda, if you wouldn't mind taking 2 minutes just to say hello and introduce yourself, and then we'll go from there. Thank you. Thanks for coming tonight.
Thank you. I actually wasn't prepared to speak. Okay. Veda Kerr, 13 Breakneck Hill Road. My family and I have lived here since 2000, so 17 years. Have raised two children through the system as well. And always felt very, very much a part of the community and have been looking for ways recently to be able to give back a little bit, find a way that I can serve. And when I was made aware of this opening, I thought this would be a good way for me to be able to serve the town in a small way. So,
great. Excellent. Thank you for coming tonight. Does anybody have any questions for Veda about this possible appointment?
No.
Good.
I'm just glad she stepped up so that we can have both parties represented adequately again.
Everybody good?
I had a chance to meet her at the Veterans breakfast and had a quick 5-minute conversation with her. She seemed very motivated and excited to get involved in town government, and we're lucky to have people like that.
Excellent. Excellent.
Thank you.
I've known Veda for several years now, and I think this is a great way to get involved and get going. I think Veda can do all kinds of great things for the town of Hockington, so hopefully this is the beginning of a long and storied volunteer career.
Appreciate your vote of confidence.
Thank you for coming tonight, Veda, and thank you for volunteering. The chair will entertain a motion to approve Veda Kerr to serve on the Board of Registrars of Voters as nominated by the Hopkinton Republican Town Committee.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Great. All set. Thank you, Veda. So you'll need to get with the town clerk, who is right behind you, and he'll take it from there.
Will do.
Thank you, Connor. You. That was very well timed. Okay. With that, we've got a public hearing we have to open right away. This is a posted public hearing for the tax classification in the town of Hopkinton. So the chair will entertain a motion to open the tax classification hearing stated in the agenda. Okay, so we have a motion and a second to open the public hearing. Thank you. So as always is the case in public hearings, we will hear from some presenters, maybe have a little dialogue between the Board of Selectmen and the presenters, and then we'll ask for the public if they want to weigh in. And the public in this case can be pretty much anybody in the town of Hopkinton or even those affiliated with the town of Hopkinton in any way. Once we get sort of the public input wrapped up, if there is any, we'll then vote to close the public hearing, and then the board will see if we can't make a decision specific to the issue in front of us. Mr. Kamalo, is you good with that process?
Yes.
Everybody good with that process? Everybody good with the process? Okay, great. All right, so with that, why don't we introduce Mr. Kamalo, why don't you introduce the whole concept of the tax classification hearing for the board as well as those at home watching.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. This is an annual process. It involves, as the Chair explained, a public hearing. In the past, the board has received and will do the same today, comments from the Board of Assessors, providing the data that then becomes the basis of the decisions that the selectmen make. As part of that presentation, the Board of Assessors will present specific questions that the Board of Selectmen have to vote upon at the conclusion of the hearing. We normally also, as part of this process, seek input from different town stakeholders. Usually, I know EMC has attended the hearing. And also, what was interesting for us leading to this process was the opportunity we had as staff to meet with the new board members to review this concept. I think for me personally, the meeting was helpful in the sense that they opened my eyes to different questions, different issues, different perspectives that will enrich this discussion tonight.
Great. Thank you. Yeah. Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Mary Delafrenny. I'm chairman of the Board of Assessors, and I'm glad to be here again. I'm just going to give an overview. You all have this letter in your packet, I'm sure. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but for the general public, I think I'm going to give some figures and throw out some clarifications. Tonight we are trying to decide whether or not to split the tax rate. And there's four ways that you can do it. You can split it, which is what the main decision is for the town of Hopkinton, is between the commercial, industrial, and personal property class and the residential class. There are some other ways that tax rates can be split within classes, which I don't feel that really would pertain to Hopkinton, given that it's split between residential and commercial is 84% to 60%, so it is mostly residential. You can split the rate within the residential class. None of this changes the amount of taxes that has to be raised within that class. It just, you know, certain properties can get taxed lower, but the burden then goes onto the rest of that class. And it works very well in communities such as Nantucket or Martha's Vineyard that can put it on a residential, much higher summer population class and give their fishing fleet, who are there year-round and live there year-round, a break on taxes. And that's kind of what that's set up for. There's also an open space discount, and where we don't have the kind of open space that this would be used for, kind of doesn't really matter. And then we have a small commercial exemption, but we only have 16% commercial industrial. So if you were to do that and reduce the rate within that class, you'd be putting a burden on the rest of the commercial and industrial properties. So that's how that works. And so I'm not going to go into any of the rest of the details of it. It's just that it's there, and it shifts. All of this is a shift. It's not a reduction in anyone's taxes. It's because whoever you shift it from is somebody else in that class is going to have to make up the difference, and that's so. I'm going to throw out some figures now for the general public, and I'm going to tell you that the total taxable value of the town now is $3,463,630,467, and that the commercial and the residential property makes up 84% of that. Commercial industrial makes up 16. And I have to say, the history of Hopkinton, we have said it's in the letter, it says for 5 years. But when I worked in this office 20-something years ago, the split was 84. A commercial has been between 84 and 85 for 20-something years. I mean, I don't really think it's changed much. So that's, even with the growth and everything that's going on, if you look at the recap sheets and you go back and you go back and go back and look at the first page, you'll find the percentage is still about the same. The average single-family assessed property is $548,595. Last year it was $525,705, difference of about $22,000. New construction of the condominium class is significant. We had 789 condominium units, an average assessment of $342,790, compared to 665 condominium units that averages $313,485 last year. So we have had a good growth in condominiums. New growth for the year is valuation-wise, $125,396,951, or taxable dollars, $2,135,510, and last year taxable dollars was $1,542,134. So we have had a good increase in growth. The categories in growth were single-family homes, $20,904,702. Condominium class, $52,049,800. Apartments and congregate housing, $22,229,000. And the personal property class at $16,495,910. So in all, across the board, we've had increases in valuation. We've had 126 building permits for single-family homes, and that is high for Hopkinton, which is good. And condominium construction, Davenport Village, Legacy Farms, Maspinock Woods, at 801 building permits for items that include additions, barns, bathrooms, decks, and they all add good value. Let's see. We have a lot of apartments, Fairview Estates Retirement Community on Elm Street, and Hopkinton Muse Construction, Freedom Way, Independence Place, and Revolution Way off Lumber Street. The property tax levy valuation of 70% up or down for the revenue that's required to fund municipal government services for the town of Hopkinton. And it gives you a chart of the past 5 years, about percents of growth. Top 10 taxpayers, I don't really think I have to read them. They haven't changed a whole lot, actually. and they are mostly commercial and industrial properties that are the top 10 taxpayers, and utility companies also in there. We have a few that are residential, such as Golden Pond, but not terribly much. It's mostly all commercial and industrial properties. So John has a presentation he'd like to make, so I am just going to wrap this up and say to everybody, make a good decision and have a nice Thanksgiving.
Thank you. Thank you, Mary Jo. Hi, John.
Hi. Any questions before we continue with a short PowerPoint?
Anybody have any questions?
Nope.
All set?
So Mary Jo chairs the Board of Assessors. We also have John Palmer with us tonight. Dr. Duffy could not attend. And I'm going to take you through just a half a dozen or so slides on the PowerPoint presentation. So she has completed part one from the Board of Assessors, which is the letter that she went through with you. And I'll take you through these slides. So at this point, the proposed tax rate for fiscal year 2017 is $16.80 per thousand. That is subject to Department of Revenue approval once all the tax forms go in. And in general, the different classes of property, as shown on some of the charts in the letter, increased from 2.5% to 8%, commercial being the highest increase at 8%, industrial being the lowest at 2.5%. Stop me if I go too fast, but she's mentioned this as well, but this chart shows the 84% residential property value in town. We have 3.9 in the commercial class, 8.8, I think, in the industrial class, and 3.3 in personal property. This shows the average single-family assessment in Hopkinton over the last several years. And she's talked about the last 2 years that went basically from 5.25 to 5.50. This is the average single-family tax bill in Hopkinton over the last several years. This compares Hopkinton, which is the third one in from the left side, with several other communities in the area, which we thought might be either geographically or demographically similar to Hopkinton. This shows the top five taxpayers just in graph form. I mean, she read or she mentioned the top 10, which we put in the letter in your packet. And this deals with the effect of shifting the tax rate. So again, we can't raise any more money in terms of the total levy, but you do have the option to shift the rate or essentially lower the residential rate and increase the rate to commercial and industrial properties. Across the bottom, it shows that if you shift from 5, 10, 15, 20, or 25%, you would effectively decrease the residential property tax by 1%, 2%, 3%, 4%, 5%. The graphs on the top show the corresponding increase in the commercial and industrial tax bill. So a 1% decrease in a residential bill would result in a 5% increase to the average commercial or industrial value in those classes. 2% is 10, 3% is 15, 4% is 20, and a 5% reduction in the residential property would result in a 25% increase in the commercial and industrial class. This shows the excess levy capacity at just over $2 million for this fiscal year and shows the history of that. And I'll entertain any questions that you have, but when you are ready, you will need to make a decision on whether or not to have an open space discount, a residential exemption, a small commercial exemption, and whether or not to have a single tax rate or a split tax rate. Once you have decided on those issues, Elaine has two copies of the LA-5, so at the end of your meeting tonight, you'll sign two copies, one which we will maintain in our file, one which has to go into the Bureau of Accounts in order to get the tax rate approved.
Finished. Okay. Thank you, John.
You're welcome.
Does anyone have any questions for John or Mary Jo?
I have one question. I noticed that there's quite a big jump in the single-family assessment from 2016 to 2017, and I also understand that you can do absolutely nothing to your house, and yet your assessment can go up because it's also a function of everything else around you, the
general desirability of the town and the value of other things that are being built. I know that in recent years, certainly on the planning board, we've made an effort to try to not limit, but as a town, we wanted to have fewer of those big single-family five-bedroom houses, and there's been quite an increase in the smaller, the two bedrooms and all. Do you see that the jump in the assessment is, can you determine, is that more a function of just the general desirability and increase in property values of Hopkinton as a town, or is it a jump in more extensively, you know, more opulent or larger actual structures being built? Can you tell where that's
both,
coming
isn't
from?
It?
Me or you?
Yeah, okay. It's a little of both, actually. And also when you do valuation, you have to use sales for assessment neighborhoods, et cetera, and you assess according to assessment neighborhoods, which isn't the same as a neighborhood. You can have, an assessment neighborhood on two different sides of town if they're the same type of property, same land, same type of is being built on it, that becomes an assessment neighborhood. So you have to look at sales each assessment neighborhood that we have in town, and then you apply them to the valuations that we've had on the houses and where they should be. Plus new construction. Oh, I'm sorry.
I thought you were done.
Go ahead.
One other comment, if I might. We need to complete what's referred to as an LA3 every year for the Department of Revenue. It's a statistical analysis, and what it does is tracks all of the sales in the previous calendar year. There were about 300 or so last year, and that's how we look at what the changes in the market are. And the difference between the 525 and the 550, rounding those two numbers, is about a 5% increase in the market over that period of time.
So, in answer to my question, it looks like a big piece of it is changes in the market more than more expansive homes. I mean, it's some of both, but the market is the big driver.
It is a combination of both because, 550 is the average value, but if you build several houses that are $1 million or $1.5 million, well, they're going to drive up that average value. So it's a combination of factors.
And just when we do that LA3, sales are culled. And, there's certain things that you have to look at that you can't count as a sale, either an overbuilt or, various categories in there, lettered in there. And boy, if you don't get it right, the DOI comes right back at you and says, hey, what about this one? So they look at it very closely, and there are sales we cannot use.
Mm-hmm. Anything else? All good?
I just want to ask one more question. You've got personal property of business. You have vacant land. You have individual homes. Can you explain how we are assessing solar? There's a solar farm going in on Hayden Row Street. There may be another one in the future up on East Main, but I know there's one.
Mr. Kamalo, for the record, I'm going to step off for a minute.
Thank you.
I just wonder how those will be valued or assessed.
Well, to begin with, we don't have any at this point, even though there are some that are proposed. If it's a homeowner with solar on their property, there is an exemption for that for the next 20 years. If you're talking about some type of commercial property that puts solar in, we generally look at it as personal property. So we look at the entire cost of the property. We start with that number. We use a depreciation schedule, which comes from our personal property vendor. We look at what the tax rate might be over the next several years, and we also look at the land value, and the land value actually switches from a residential to a commercial use if it's a solar use. So we have had some experience with the proposals, even though we don't have anything in final form yet, but we do a spreadsheet over a 20 or 25-year period of the solar lease in order to value it using those various components.
House, but I know there is one that's being installed right now on Hayden Row Street.
No, nothing that has come before. Nothing that's come before the Board of Assessors at this point. Something that's been approved, or?
It's up. I don't know if it's running yet, but it's up.
That never came.
It's under construction.
But it's under construction.
Construction permit. We need the permit.
Yeah. But I can't answer your question. We haven't seen any documentation on that yet.
Thank you.
I'm in the solar business, folks. So I had to leave for that particular discussion. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so with that initial dialogue wrapped up, is anyone here from the public that would like to address the issue before the board or the others tonight? Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Dan Lorero, and I'm here representing EMC.
Dan, would you mind just sliding over a little closer to that microphone there so we pick up your voice? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, John. Hi, Dale.
Good evening. My name is Dan Lorero. I'm the finance director at EMC Corporation. And as the board has presented, EMC is the largest commercial owner here in EMC. As shown here on this information, we're almost double the next closest commercial. And by shifting 25% from a single tax rate to a dual tax rate, you'd be adding a significant amount of tax to EMC. My colleague and I calculate that'd be about a $650,000 impact to EMC in the upcoming year. So with that being said, I kindly ask that the selectmen vote not to move forward with the dual tax rate. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Dale. Any other members of the public want to address the issue? Mr. Weissmantle. Dare I ask, name and address, please.
Burned into my mind.
Ken Weissmantle, 145 Ash Street.
Really?
I'm speaking in support of the single tax rate. If the late Dick Egan was here, he would be speaking for it, and I'm going to just take the liberty of speaking for him and say, please continue with the singles tax rate. We went with the dual for a year or a few years ago, like 30 years ago almost, and it took us a bunch of years to get back to a single, which is the fair tax rate for all the people, commercial and residential in Hopkinton. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? All set? John, would you mind putting that slide back up that showed if we did the shift, what would happen?
It's up on my screen. He's got to put it up here for us.
Okay. We're blank up here.
Okay.
Yep.
There we go. Not quite.
The shift.
I'm sorry. Oh, the shift.
Yeah, the shift. Sorry.
Sorry. This is frozen. Will you a shift?
No.
This won't go?
You've got shift and control.
It's frozen.
Okay. All right, well,
you start it over. I'll start.
Oh,
wait a minute. I'll start it over.
Wait a minute.
Here we go. So just for conversation, and some folks may have not seen this in the past, but this is very typical of what we've seen year after year after year. If we were to take our commercial tax base and increase them across the board 5%, in other words, go to a dual tax rate and tax the commercial taxpayers an additional 5%, we'd save 1% on the residential tax
$3.
Base, which is basically nothing. But the commercial is paying a huge number. If we increase, so we'll go all the way to the right there, if we increase the commercial tax base 25%, which is a huge number on the commercial tax base, the residents would pick up only 5% across the board. So while we put a huge burden on one side of Hopkinton, the 16% side, the commercial side, the residential impact is still very small and negligible, but it would cause some other issues, I think, very serious issues for our commercial tax base. And then that 84-16 that we're trying to get to 80-20 will go to 95-5 in about 2 years' time, I suspect, if we did something like that. So I myself am opposed to going to anything that would cause even the smallest change there. I just don't think it doesn't impact the taxpayers, the homeowners, but it would dramatically impact our commercial tax base. But with that, I'm probably getting ahead of myself, and I apologize. So there's anyone else here going to comment on the public hearing portion of this discussion? John?
Do you want a mathematical number to help that illustration, or?
I don't need it.
Yeah, okay.
I'm good. So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing for the tax classification discussion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion on the motions? Motion. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so the public hearing is closed, and now we'll move to the deliberation stage. If you guys can stay there, we'll kind of probably move through this fairly quickly. So I got a little ahead of myself there without closing the public hearing. Mr. Catino, any thoughts?
Yeah, I concur with the single tax rate. When Joe was going through the numbers and the last couple of years, and it just doesn't pan out. With only 16%, it doesn't pan out, and it puts too much burden on the commercial side. I concur with a single tax rate.
Okay. This is right.
Yeah, I cannot say how strongly I support maintaining the single tax rate. If we had, you know, a broader commercial base, a bitter split than the 84-16, it would be spread out over more. But, you know, it seems to fly right in the face of everything we're trying to do as a community to be business friendly, to bring in more businesses. We have empty storefronts and empty businesses on South Street. And it just seems to me it's really penny wise and pound foolish for us to be going against just what we want to be encouraging in this town, which is a good, strong business base. So absolutely support the single tax rate across the board.
Mr. Tedstone.
Well, I'm actually for a split tax rate, but not at 84-16. If we had a more of a percentage of businesses where that every 1% doesn't hit those guys 5%, then I'd be more inclined to go for the dual tax rate. But I don't know if we do enough in town to try to get businesses in. I know when Legacy Farms went in, there was going to be a whole bunch of commercial property down there, and there's none. And you know, it is what it is, and we don't make those decisions, and I certainly didn't make those decisions when I was on the board. But at an 84-16, I can't support putting all that on the businesses. If it were a little bit better, percentages weighted towards commercial, and yes, but I can't do it this way.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Kamalo, any thoughts on the question?
Nothing to add other than I think one more time to commend the Board of Assessors and the Principal Assessor with his team for a job well done. I think the information you presented is professionally done. It's clear to understand. And also, I will share with the Board in my discussions with John and his team, there is a great deal of effort that is also going towards advertising and letting the community know about the other tax relief programs that are in place, and I think that is also helpful for this discussion.
Okay. Mrs. Lazarus, as a director of land use and planning, do you have any thoughts on the subject?
No, I think it's just interesting to hear the impact of the growth. I think when the town voted Legacy Farms, for example, certain things were anticipated, and it's come to pass.
Okay. Thank you. So I thought I heard some recommendations kind of wrapped in the presentation there, directly or indirectly. Do you guys have any recommendations that you'd like to make specifically, or are you comfortable with your presentation as it is?
I don't think we're supposed to recommend. Oh.
Not supposed to recommend?
Yes. Yeah.
As a citizen, it makes no sense to tax the small group that benefit the residential. I mean, that division is way too far. The only thing that's fair is to single rate in this community.
Okay.
That's my own opinion, but not as an assessor.
Got it.
And just make a comment. We do have some cities and towns in the state that actually have a bigger commercial base than they do residential. Works really well for them because it gives the residents a good break and doesn't really make a huge difference to the commercial industrial at all. We don't have that here. So,
okay. Mr. Kamalo, how about the other questions specific to the open space exemption, the small commercial, et cetera? Do we have to? I don't recall really getting into those in the past.
Yes, the board has to act on those questions. I think what I've heard in the past is the chair calls for a motion, for example, an open space discount, and no motion comes forth. Similarly with residential, small commercial exemptions. So in other words, call for the motion, and if there's no motion, then there's no action by the board.
Okay. So keep me on the straight and narrow here as I try to work through this, okay? Just if you would, please. So the chair will entertain a motion to grant an open space discount. Is anyone inclined to make such a motion and put a percentage of that discount in their motion? Hearing none, we'll move to the next motion. So that does not go forward. The chair will entertain a motion to grant a residential exemption for the tax class. Residential exemption of what? Mary Jo.
That's splitting, like I said, that works in places like Martha's Vineyard, and it's splitting the rate within the residential class. So some residents would get a break, and the rest of the burden would go on other residents.
Okay, so the chair will entertain a motion of some sort to split the residential exemption at some percentage included in the motion. Hearing none, we'll move along. The chair will entertain a motion to grant a small commercial exemption similar to that for a residential split exemption.
That small commercial, again, would only split the rate within the commercial class.
Right.
So the burden would go on another group of commercial properties to lower some commercial properties.
So hearing none, we'll move on to the next motion. The chair will entertain a motion to approve a single tax rate for FY 2017.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve a single tax rate for fiscal 17. Mr. Kamal, is the motion in order?
Yes, it is.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? And there you have it. We have a single tax rate for FY 17. And finally, the chair will entertain a motion to approve and sign the LA-5 form for the Department of Revenue.
Second.
Mr. Kamal, you agree with that motion?
That's correct. Thank you.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. So we will have a single tax rate going forward for FY 17.
Just while we're here, and you mentioned the exemptions, I just wanted to bring it to the public's attention once again, because we do this at the Senior Center in a number of places around town, that we have veterans exemptions, we have exemptions for senior citizens, we have exemptions for blind people, we have exemptions for widows and widowers, and then the Tax Relief Committee also has I'm on that committee too, of assisting people that are having real problems. So they're available, the applications are available in the assessor's office, and we welcome anyone to come and talk to us about it.
Mary Jo, thank you for coming tonight. You guys do great work. John, thank you, and please give Dr. Duffy our best.
He's not doing well, by the way.
Yeah.
He's in Whittier. I visited him last Friday, and he's getting quite frail.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mary Jo.
Thank you. Happy Thanksgiving again.
Yep. To you. Okay. So next up, and we are running a few minutes behind here, I believe we have some guests to join us to explain what's going on with Hopkinton Family Day. Do we have friends of the Hopkinton Anniversary Celebrations group here this evening? Mrs. Click.
Hello.
How are you?
Good. This is Paul Witcher.
Hello,
who's
Paul.
He's also been very busy man last year. He was our coordinator for the parade, where the Friends did the parade last year. So anyways, yes, we are here to introduced the idea of having a family day in Hockington. And first of all, I want to start by saying that our name has been officially changed to Friends of Hockington. We have renamed ourselves and registered our new name with the state. It's been recognized. So that's what our group will be called going forward.
Great, thank you.
We have also solicited some interest in the idea of having a family day. Dale Danahy sent out a very well-written introduction to the idea of having a family day to a list of clubs, business, well, mostly clubs in Hockington, committees and clubs in Hockington. And we've heard from more than a half a dozen in the positive answers. And so we're going to continue to do that. So those are my two items that I am telling you tonight. So it looks like we will have some help. Paul and I met with Mr. Camano back in the late summer, I think.
Yeah.
And we told him we were going to do that, that part of the reason of having this is that we really wanted to include any group in Hockington that would like to do this. So we've done that. We've started that process. And we're waiting to hear from more and more of them. And now I'd like Paul to speak for a few minutes and give you a little bit more information.
Great. Thank you.
Okay.
Well, when we had the anniversary celebration after it was over, we and some of the panel as well have said we'd like to have a celebration, as many towns do, Ashland Day, and and Holliston has their day, and Southborough the same way. So we came up with some numbers, and we came up with some options. And the really two options are, we have a family day with no fireworks, or we have a family day with fireworks. And since fireworks are the most expensive portion of anything, even for us on the anniversary, it was in the neighborhood of $40,000. So those are our two options. And when we met earlier, we proposed a number that we thought it would take for us to put on a family day with fireworks, which is about $30,000.
Not the total.
There would be other
fireworks.
Other groups also, we hope, participating and helping out with events and the cost, as Ann had mentioned. But we can't, as a small committee or even as a bunch of groups that take part, afford to put that kind of money up for fireworks. So that's why we're here. We'd like the town to appropriate it, and would be, if the town chose to have something annually, it would be an annual cost that would take place to have a family day with fireworks. Now, I realize that has to go into the budget and into the town meeting, but that's why we're here, to try and get something going and see if you agree with that. And I'm going to ask Pat O'Brien to come up next, and he'll tell you about some of the events we'd like to do for the family day aside from the fireworks being the most expensive. And Pat, we've done family days, if you, many of you can remember, probably 15 years ago, and that went away only because of, really, there was changing of the fields and the school being built, and then partially a lot of the volunteers being just worn out from doing it for many years. So we're trying to reactivate that, and on top of that, since most people really love the fireworks and wanted to have more of that, that's what we'd like to do. So I'm going to let you talk, Pat, about it.
Oh, thank you. Good evening, Board. First thing is, I'm new to the committee and just have great fond memories of the 300th festival that they had. And in all my time in Hopkinton, I don't think the town has had a better event than that. You saw ages from infants to the elderly, and they were there all night, and the count of residents that were there was incredible. So, like Yanny was saying, going at, after that, people wanted to keep this tradition alive. And I think a theme, and if you could see the makeup of this committee, are pretty much longstanding Hopkinton residents. And there's been a great tradition in this town, and they want to try to keep the spirit up. You know, the unfortunate thing, sometimes those things come with cost. And it seemed like a lot of the people stayed to that event on the 300th because of the fireworks. So fireworks seems to be really the linchpin of what we need to do. But before that, we're still kicking around different ideas. As Ann said, we're reaching out to as many civic organizations in town, local groups, and we're talking with the Ashland Committee, and we're just trying to get what works. We don't want to bite off a little bit too much the first year. You know, we want to grow each year. But some of the things, you know, that we certainly want to incorporate in that, you know, we're kicking around, as you knew, remember this year, Joe Regan had a great lumberjack contest. And, you know, we're talking about maybe integrating that into this day. You know, for the kids, the old traditions of the doll carriage things and the bike parade and stuff like that. The entertainment of the local bands, ranging from the high school kids all the way to, you know, maybe Steve Spector and the Hot Acoustics, you know, a wide variety of that. So we're trying to touch base to all Hopkinton area organizations to see how they want to get involved. The Evan Girardi event that was up there, you know, they put a great family day together there. So we'll tap into different events that have happened, and we'll try to get together that will incorporate the wishes of the whole community and make this a great annual event.
Great. Thank you very much. Thanks for coming in tonight. Well, why don't we go out to the board first, Mr. Cortina?
Yeah, ever since the 300th, people have been coming up to me at church at various other events saying, are we going to do anything else? Can the Board of Selectmen get it together so we did once, and even this year? And I knew it was going to be too hard because even the 300 took years to plan. But people want it. And when it comes to cost, everybody has celebrations in their families. Even this Thanksgiving coming up. And everybody knows that there's a cost to just even having family and extended family to their houses for just to celebrate Thanksgiving and Christmas and birthdays. And I believe that there is an appetite for the public to raise the funds to have a yearly celebration. It was just, as you said, Pat, it was a wonderful event. All ages just craving it. And I believe that it's something we really should look into and see what we can do to get the revenue to put on this event yearly. It's something I know everybody will look forward to. The fireworks were just spectacular. Not that we could actually recreate that, but it would be spectacular. But even more than that, just the other events leading up to it, as you said, the bands, the food trucks, the lumberjack was just, that was lots of fun. And Polyarts, the day of, just you know, great events, and it really brings the town together. And that's the kind of stuff all, as you said, neighboring towns have, and I really believe that people will vote to have something like this. And we should.
Thank you. Mrs. Wright.
Yeah, do you have any feel at all, Pat or Mr. Witcher, if you took the fireworks out, what kind of costs might be involved in an event without fireworks? I mean, I was thinking of a lot of stuff that could be kind of homemade. The lumberjack thing. I remember one year Historical Society up at Poly Arts had the old clothes and let the kids, you know, each get dressed up like in an old time outfit and had their picture taken. Stuff that you kind of fun you make in the town that doesn't cost you much. Any feeling if we weren't talking fireworks?
Yeah. Well, we've talked that a little bit about that, and we've talked with a number of people who put on Ashland Day. And we really think that we'd probably be in the neighborhood of $10,000 to $12,000 to do something like that. Maybe not have a big name bands and things like that, but to do a bunch of small things for and put them all together like Ashland Day. They have a train ride that they rent for the kids, and they have a couple of inflatables that they have, and food and things like that. So, you know, it's in that neighborhood. Okay. It might be a little less depending on what we do. As Pat mentioned, we'd like to see it grow over time. But
well, I ask, if I may, Mr. Chair, because, you know, perhaps one thought could be doing this in, you know, we had 2015, you do the fireworks in, say, five-year anniversary increments, and you use that 5 years to do the fun day that includes some kind of a fundraising component where the different activities, you do bring in some funds, and it's understood that each year is a fundraising event towards the five-year fireworks anniversary. Perhaps even Family Fun Day could get a marathon bid and have someone that runs to raise money for the friends of whatever the new town name is, but, you know, just using 30,000 as an example, if you did that in 5 year increments, you raise, you know, 6,000 a year with the big year every fifth, where you had the, you know, maybe there's just a way it could be done in increments and have it every few years and use it as a fundraiser for the town to work towards that. It's one thought.
Mr. Tudson.
Well, just seeing the guys on the guys and girls on the board, you two, Mrs. Click, Dale, Joe Regan, that brings people that have been here for a long time that have seen back when the Horribles Parade was a lot of fun, and there were, you know, it was a 45-minute parade or an hour parade of everything from the antique fire trucks to horses to everything. We've had, in the past, we've had events at Cornell's in the fields we've had charity softball games, which brought a ton of people out. We've had the Make-A-Wish Foundation, where we had certain things, and it brought the town out. We're not going to, if we don't jump on something like this with the board members that we have, the committee people that we have, people are going to start falling off. And those are the people that know the town. And they talk about the 300th. 300th was a great time. The 275th was pretty fun, too. I was around for that. And I wasn't around for the 250th. But I had a real good time at the 275th. And the past Hall Bowls parades. And just the town has a ton of history and people that are historians in the town that I think we can do a really good job of pulling something like this together. I'll help you guys out as much as I certainly can, but I think it's a great idea, and I'm behind you 100% on it.
Thank you. I just like to add that in our discussions with Ashland, which is we've had the most discussions with, they wind up every year with just right on the edge. Some years there are a few hundred dollars in the hole, some years there are a few hundred dollars. And they run a huge silent auction and everything. They approach it as to keep, which is, I guess, my thought, but obviously that's just my thought, is to keep Family Day a very low-cost event so that families and people come and it's not, doesn't take a lot of money to do things. And that's all I'd like to say. That's my feeling. I think that's our committee's feeling, is we'd like to not have to charge admissions or anything like that and keep the cost for rides and things like that for free down at a very low level. So thank you very much.
Okay. Just bear with me for a couple of minutes or a minute or so for some business questions. So, Mr. Kamala, are we talking about if we were to support something like this, working it into the FY18 budget as in the operating lines? Are we talking about an article, or how do we go about this mechanically?
I think, suffice to say, I have had very delightful conversations with Paul and Glick. In answer to your question, either way, I think the goal is to find a way to get this into the FY18 budget, either it be an article or an operating budget expense. I will tell you, in my conversations with Anne and Paul, I was happy to learn that this continues a tradition that the town has had for some time. For some reason, the town took a pause. Secondly, people, all of us know this, people are asking for some form of celebration. Most of the residents really enjoy the 300th. So the people are asking for something. And then thirdly, in my discussions with Paul and Anne, we have focused on lowering the cost, but also realizing that there are things that people are asking for that will cost money. Fireworks, everybody who talks about a celebration is raising the question regarding their desire to see fireworks as part of the program, and that's the high cost item in their preliminary budget. So the ask is twofold: one, how can the board facilitate the continuation of this discussion? No decisions are being made today, and then secondly, for the board and the town manager to find a way to get this into the FY18 budget.
All right, and I'm good with that, and I appreciate that. Personally, I'd like to see us trying to figure it out. What I saw the day of the fireworks, the night of the fireworks, the day and the night of the fireworks, and I think maybe it's having been involved in town government for about 15 years now, and getting to know, because of, I've only been in town since 2000, right? But in this role, you meet everybody along the way. You meet the Brennan Tenstones of the world that have been here since Earth was created, and you meet people that just moved to town last year. And all those people that I've met in my 15 years were at the 300th. It wasn't just those that have been here for 40 years, and it wasn't just those that moved in 2 years ago that have little kids. Everybody was there. The whole town really came together and celebrated a great day, a great night, and all the other events we did throughout the 300th celebration. I love going to the different cornerstones, or whatever we call them, the markers around town, and checking them all out like selectmen are supposed to do every year, apparently, which we don't do. But I just thought it was a great event, and it really brought everybody in Hopkinton together. And I think the community, frankly, is craving that, to Mr. Catino's point. I think the community is looking for ways that we can come together. Where I grew up, it was Friday Night Lights. It was under the lights playing football, and 10,000 people would come to a little high school football game. That's where people would gather. And I think that the Hopkinton community is looking for ways to do that. So I would very much support trying to figure this out. $30,000 is $30,000. It's a lot of money, and everybody knows that I kind of get cranky about money and spending it in town. But I think the return on the investment of bringing the community together and making the community strong and making the community proud of who we are and what we do, this thing, this is a great brochure on Hopkinton. You look through this, and then you have the gentleman come join us earlier this evening and talk about his daughter and the things they're doing to honor her memory. Those are the kinds of things that the Hopkinton residents want to do, and I think it's incumbent upon us when we can to support that. 30 grand is 30 grand, but on an $80 million budget, I'm sure we can figure it out. So I would very much support it, and I'd like to continue to have the dialogue.
Everybody likes a party sometimes.
And everybody likes a party, sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay.
So with that, we'll table it for this evening. I think you've got some pretty good sense for where the board's coming from. And we'll try and continue, we will continue the dialogue and see what we can sort out for FY18, which is really upon us right now. Okay?
Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you very much.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you for carrying the torch. Okay, next up, we have a general bond obligation, or general obligation bonds that we have to vote. Mr. Kamala, Would you introduce the idea or the issue before us, please?
Yes. Through the chair, there is a request before the board prepared by the town treasurer and supported by the town CFO. The request is twofold, the first being a bonding request for projects that were approved recently at town meeting. And the second aspect of the request is refinancing projects that were approved several years back. My review of the information presented to the board led me to recommend approval by the board of the two requests. The timing with regard to the new bond, I think, is perfect, and Chris can speak to that. And then second, in terms of refinancing, the information I have is that that refinancing will save the town approximately $428,000 over the term of the bond.
So it's $428,000. There was a zero off there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, 1,000. Sorry,
1,000.
Yeah.
428,000.
Okay. Yeah.
We just spent that.
Yeah. Got it.
Yeah.
Okay. Why don't we take them one at a time, if we could, please? Why don't we start with the new bond, and then we'll talk about the refinancing. Please, gentlemen.
Well, I can speak on both. Well, the new bond, it's part of it is $8 million for the Center Elementary School, $9 million for the new DPW building, $6.2 million for the library, $1 million, and those are already articles that had been approved back in 2015 and 14. And then the new articles were this past town meeting, May town meeting, $1 million for water infrastructure, water tank of $100,000, new water mains of $100,000, a new dump truck for $200,000, and then water department equipment for $50,000. That totals for the new issue $24,650,000.
So, at the risk of being a little boring, could you repeat the items and the amounts one more time, please, so in case anybody missed any of those?
For the new Center Elementary School.
So for the new elementary school.
Exactly.
Yeah.
$8 million.
$8 million.
DPW facility, the new building. $9 million.
Okay.
Library. The new building for the library, $6,200,000. Water infrastructure, $1 million. New water tank, $100,000. Water mains, $100,000. Dump truck, $200,000. And water department equipment, $50,000. For a grand total of $24 million. $650,000.
All those items in the water department or the water infrastructure, are those paid for, are those accounted for in the operating budget debt service line, or are those accounted for out of the enterprise fund?
Those are entirely out of the enterprise fund. Anything you see on the financial plan is general fund debt only.
Got it. Okay. So we have $24,650,000 that we need to approve for all the new projects that we have voted in recent years. These are the investments that we've been talking a lot about in the last few months as we get ready for this year's budget that's coming up. And now it's time to start paying the bill for those investments. So it's a significant amount of money. It's going to impact our budget discussions. We've had a couple of us attending different meetings and going to the school committee meetings and listening on their thoughts about the budgets and so forth. So it's just important that we all understand that town meeting said we're going to buy a new school, we're going to build a new school, we're going to build a new DPW, we're going to build a new library, we're going to do those things, we're going to make those investments. But now the community has to also recognize that we have to pay for those. And this bond of $24,650,000 is the start of that payment plan, basically. Because I think all in, those projects run about $70 million. Is that correct?
I don't think so.
No, 31.
The only one with a significant amount remaining to borrow is the school.
Is the school.
Yeah.
So how much is left on the school? Oh, because the state, we don't have to borrow
the
reimbursement piece, do we?
No.
We're chipping in approximately $30
million. So, and this is the first right?
We borrowed so $2 million back in May. We did a bond issue back in May.
Correct.
And part of that was for $2 million. So this would be $8 million towards the new school, total of $10 million.
So that's $10 million out of 30 some.
That's correct.
Okay. Where did I come up with $70 million the other day?
I think what you're referring to, Brian, is the town's total debt obligation as of now, including these projects.
Okay. All right. So anyway, a lot of money in play here, and something. I mean, typically when these bond requests come before us, you know, it's for $1 million or $2 million. It was town meeting approved. Yep, done. But $24 million is a different animal. So, any questions? Any comments from the board on the first issue?
I have one question. The bid was for $29,480, but the bond issue is $29,250. That $230,000 difference, is that because that's what we asked them to bid on, but the actual amount is actually that we're going to be bonding is less?
No, the refunding amount, the initial estimated amount when we first started the process, before we actually came up with a final figure, was $4,830,000 for the refunding portion. And as it turned out, we're refunding $4,600,000. That's the bottom number. The refunding bonds for the 2006 and 2008.
That's getting into the second issue, basically, of right, the refinancing. Yeah.
But my question was on these documents here, 29,480 general obligation municipal multipurpose loan, and that's what Baird Company bid on. 29,480, it says, but we're bonding 29,250. See, in fact, it says at the top of our agenda, 29,480 bond issue, but then it says we will consider approving a bond issue in the total amount of 29,250. It's a $230,000 difference in those two. Now, the figures you quoted us about, the 24,650 and the 4,600, those add up to 29,250.
Right.
But this says 29,480.
When they went out for the bond, which the bond was bid on last week, mm-hmm. the bond was already bid on last week, and prior to them adjusting this number down to the $4,600,000, the estimated amount for the refunding was $4,830,000, which was part of the $29,480,000. Right. And after the bids came in, it was deemed that the amount for the refunding was, which was an estimated amount at that time, was adjusted to the $4,600,000.
You're just looking at an old number.
So what right. we're going to be agreeing?
We're
to
actually borrowing. We're going to be we're
the
be
lower number.
The lower number.
Borrowing less, a lower number.
Okay. Yep.
I won't pretend to understand the refunding, but it's very complicated, and,
sure.
and it depends on the timing, and so it's not a simple
I didn't
process.
Understand it either, Chris. I just wanted to make sure with this $230,000 difference that I'm clear what we're agreeing on.
That was just that yes. was an old.
I had said that. I said, is this going to create a question when I was talking to
it
my
did.
Financial advisor?
Thank you.
It did.
So, Mr. Kamal, just to clarify, we're really taking, I thought we were going to be able to break this in two, that bond issues for the 29,250, which is the full amount, including the refinance piece. Right, so we've got to do one motion.
Yes, the motion is okay. A single motion. I thought just for the ease of discussion, you wanted to break it into
yeah,
two.
Yeah, I got it.
It's one number, it's one issue.
So it's 24,650 new stuff, total. And we're refinancing 4,006, not 4,830, what it was. We're doing 4,006 to refinance. That's where we're picking up that 428K.
So can I just ask, sure. The town has already voted to spend this.
Correct.
So what are we doing here?
We have to approve the bond issue.
Okay, so we're just making sure that the person that we're doing this has the lowest interest rate. And
this transaction before the board usually takes about 30 seconds.
Okay.
But given the amount of money, we're just talking about it more. That's all. We really don't have a whole lot to say here. That's, we're just
it's not like we can say, well, actually, I don't want to spend $200,000 on a truck. We just have to get this approved.
Yeah, we're just administering the wishes of town meeting.
In the refunding is actually we're experiencing a significant savings, as you can see, over the over what we would have paid. Sooner or later, those will dry up as, you know, all the old higher interest rate issues are retired or come down. There's actually restrictions against refunding for a certain amount of years. Otherwise, you can't get qualified investors to bid on them because they don't want the rug pulled out under them in year three, say.
Yeah. Okay. Any other thoughts or questions? Mr. Catino, you good?
Good.
Mrs. Wright? Mr. Tedstone? Yeah. Mr. Kamala?
We're all set. And Mr. Chair, you have a copy of the motion?
Yeah, I'm going to let one of my colleagues. I think we have a motion to my right. On the bond issue, yep, that's it.
I move to adopt the votes as written on the attached document titled Votes of the Board of Selectmen relative to the issuance of the general obligation bonds.
So moved.
So we have a motion.
Second.
By Mr. Catino, and a second by Mr. Tedstone. Mr. Kamala, are you good with that motion?
Yes, I am.
The motion doesn't specify the amount.
The document that is attached specifies the amount.
And we don't have to verbalize that?
I'm looking at somebody called Ray Miaris.
Mr. Miaris, do we have to verbalize the amount of the bond in the motion, or can we just reference the document that has that?
It's okay.
Thank you. Yeah. Guys, good with the motion? Any further discussion? All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Now we have another, the other document. Does that have to be voted on as well?
Which one was that now?
Can you remember the one that?
The one that was emailed to. I think it's in the package.
Yes, we have. Yes, the board will sign the document after the.
Do they have to vote on
the close of the meeting?
I'm not sure.
By doing the motion, I think we can sign the document.
Okay. Yeah. I think they voted. Okay. Yes. Yes.
No, that's a good question. Yes.
Yeah.
Good question.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Much. Appreciate you coming in tonight. Okay. Next up, we have a change of manager request for Cornell's Irish Pub. My apologies for running about 10 minutes behind here. We have Mr. and Mrs. Scanlon here this evening, Alan and Colin. Good evening. How you guys doing?
Good.
Good. I have an uncle Colin and a nephew Colin. I don't think I have to recuse myself here, but anyway. Mr. Kamala, do you want to just introduce this for us, please?
Yes. The request specifically is to change. I have the board consider changing the manager of the operation. We have circulated the application to all the relevant town departments. Did not receive any objections. And our recommendation to the board is that you approve the change.
Okay. Mr. Tedstone, any thoughts? Mrs. Wright?
No, I mean, the families have done a great job taking Cornell's over from Rob Cornell and seem to run a very good operation. I know Mrs. Scanlon is there most of the time, so I can understand why they want to turn it over to you. I have no questions or objections.
Mr. Catino?
Yeah, all the paperwork's in order. I'm good with it. Even the sketch is very good.
So I've stopped by on occasion and really like the cheeseburger. I hope the cheeseburger will not be impacted by this change.
Yeah.
I think I know who was making the cheeseburger anyway. It probably wasn't you.
Definitely not.
I think I made one for you last weekend.
Did indeed. It was very good. Thank you. So even though I'm a customer, I'm not going to recuse myself from this vote. I think you guys do a great job running the establishment. Every time I go in, you know, I'm always kind of looking around and just doing my job as a citizen, but doing my job as a selectman at the same time. And I think it's all good. So I have no issue at all, and happy to support whatever it is you guys want to do to run the business. So, Mr. Kamala.
Yes. As is the case, in most cases when licensees come before the board does reiterate its position in terms of how seriously you take alcohol licenses. I think in your message too, you may need to emphasize the town's interest in ensuring that Cornell's observes the occupancy permits limits. They now have live entertainment events that may draw larger crowds. I think it's important that the town, as well as your team, work collaboratively in making sure that you do respect the occupancy limits.
I always have and I always will. I don't understand what you mean live entertainment. We don't have live entertainment at Cornell's because we don't have a license for it. We have the jukebox and the TVs.
That's live.
Exactly, that's live.
I thought you meant the music and people coming in.
No.
Anything else?
No, that's it.
So, I was going to kind of come back to the business side of this after I talked about the cheeseburgers. So I think, to Mr. Kamalo's point, you do run a great establishment. I hope it's a successful one for you. I think it is for the town. But to Mr. Kamalo's point, and something we do talk about with everybody that comes in, is we talk about their various licenses that we have out there. We take the responsibility of overseeing the licenses very seriously. We've had some incidents in town, none at Cornell's that I know of, and we would know about them. But we have had incidents in town, and they've been serious incidents, and people could have been seriously hurt. So keep doing what you're doing. Please be mindful of your patrons and how well they're doing while they're in there, and make sure that you follow all those rules and regs as they're out there. As you have been from what we can tell, and I'm sure you'll continue to do so. But we do take it serious, and we hope that you're going to continue to have a perfectly clean and squeaky clean record going forward.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the change of manager from Colin Scanlon to Ellen Scanlon.
I move to approve the change of manager from Colin Scanlon to Ellen Scanlon. Cornell's Irish Pub, 229-80.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Have a good night. Happy Thanksgiving.
You too.
Thank you.
Will there be breakfast on Thanksgiving?
There'll be a buffet breakfast from 8 until 11.
I'll see you then.
Speaking of overcrowding.
Thanks,
okay.
Guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good night. Next up, item number 8 on the agenda is the Hopkinton Public Library update. We're going to have Deborah Irvin join us, who is our Hopkinton Public Library interim director, and Heather Backman.
Backman. Good job. Most people get it right.
The adult services librarian, give us an update on what's happening with the library and some of the programs therein. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming tonight.
Well, thank you for giving us this opportunity to give you an update on the library. As you know, 11 months ago, the library moved to a temporary location at 65 South Street, and library services and programs have been continuing in this smaller temporary space. And I want to say we couldn't continue with our programs if it weren't for the generosity of many groups in our town, including St. John's Church, and the Historical Society, and Town Hall, and the HCA, with all of them allowing us to use their spaces, and as well as the Senior Center, we've been able to continue with the great programming that the library is known for. And just a few little statistics for you. We moved about 40% of the adult and teen collection and approximately 50% of the children's collection to the temporary space, and we've been continuing to purchase new items since moving there. We've registered 466 new patrons this year for library cards, and the use of our collections have been steady. My colleague Heather is going to give you some updates and information about future plans and maybe a little more detail about what we've been doing.
So, as Deb said, we've been active in the temporary space.
We've had lots going on. I'm going to give you a few of what we think are the best highlights of the past year. The summer reading program, which we launched on the town common with an after-school event, was a resounding success for all ages, and it was the first year where we offered dedicated adult and teen summer reading programs as well as for children. We've been hosting Women for Women, a career support group that has been created at the instigation of community members. That's a group that's been growing in popularity since it started just a few months ago. We're looking at having to have it meet outside of our temporary space because we're running out of room to host the number of people who are showing up. And we think it's one great example of how the library helps people to grow in their work life as well as their personal lives. The superintendent of schools recently responded to our request to have the local school bus stop at the 65 South Street parking lot so that students could continue to come to the library after school the way that they always did to our downtown location. And we've also requested that the senior center bus stop the library on a weekly basis so that seniors who are not able to drive can still come and use their library. Finally, we've got a telescope on order from the Aldrich Astronomical Society Library Telescope Program, thanks to the generosity of our friends of the library group. It's going to get here in January. It's going to be available to circulate to patrons. And we're also going to be offering a variety of programs related to astronomy and science to highlight this exciting addition to our collection. While in our temporary space, we're of course looking forward to our new building. We're very excited about the various opportunities that it's going to provide. Among them, we look forward to expanding services to our teen population. We were able to hire a part-time young adult librarian, Ann Thigh, in April of this year, and she's already had a strong impact on our services. For example, she's created a teen advisory group, which currently has 20 active members. She's also had a remarkable impact on our circulation for the teen collection. From the teen collection, the circulation now is an average of 11% more per month than the previous year. So she's a firecracker. She's great. We love her to death. She's having amazing effect. In the new building, we're going to have a designated space for teens where they will be able to study together or independently. They'll have a laptop bar, comfortable seating, and areas for collaboration as well as quiet study. And we look forward to supporting Anne and her teen advisors as they sustain this growth and create an engaging, active, safe place for teens in our very first dedicated space for that population. We also look forward to providing a larger, vibrant, and friendly children's room bursting with life that offers a wealth of resources for our youngest community members to develop a lifelong love of reading and learning. We look forward to offering more programs to educate and delight people of all ages, and in doing so, expand our established relationships with local community organizations and schools. And there was some discussion earlier about building a strong community. We absolutely look forward to the opportunity to participate in this community building and be a place for that community to come together to learn, work, and socialize throughout an expanded and welcoming space, including holding meetings and events in our three new event rooms. We look forward to taking full advantage of these opportunities. We're also considering elements of the new building that are going to affect how and where we need to improve upon our current high level of service to the town. For instance, in the old library building, we serve the public from two floors. Soon we're going to have three floors with a service point on each floor, and we're currently analyzing our staffing requirements to determine what is needed to continue providing prompt, accessible service in that environment. And we are hearing right now from the public that we're providing wonderful service. I wanted to wrap up by telling you a little bit about the responses to our customer satisfaction survey, which we have ongoing. We just looked at responses submitted in the past 12 months, and I'm pleased to report we received consistently high ratings on providing prompt, friendly, and courteous service, and on handling requests in a knowledgeable and professional manner. Of the 27 responses, 24 rated themselves very satisfied with the service they received from the library, and the other three people said they were satisfied. Comments left on the survey mention our staff more than any other individual topic, and they are uniformly positive. One great example of the kinds of comments that we see is this one. The staff is what makes every visit to the Hopkinton Public Library work so well. Without exception, the staff is seasoned, intelligent, courteous, firm, and presentable. We're all looking forward to the new facility, where we will be able to continue offering this high level of service to the community. In the spring of 2017, we will begin the early stages of a strategic planning process to guide us in this exciting transition. We hope that you'll come by and visit our location on 65 South Street if you haven't already. And we hope that we might see you at some of our programs in the future. And thank you for having us.
Great. Thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Tedstone,
No, you guys,
You guys do a great job. My wife and kids utilize the library a whole lot more than I do. But they go there frequently, and from over here to South Street, they're quite a bit, and it's a great resource to have. Kids look forward to going there, and so does my wife. So
that's great.
Keep up the great work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mrs. Wright, anything?
No, I don't have any questions, but it was a great report, and you guys are doing a fantastic job with diminished resources. You would think that you'd be kind of going on a skeleton operation, but it sounds like you're just going gangbusters, and that's just remarkable, and really speaks well to your staff, and congratulations. Thank you for that wonderful report.
Mr. Tino.
It really is humming along, and it really shows that the transition into the new building really will be pretty seamless. And I just loved every Sunday morning I went to church to see the changes with the steel going up and everything else happening there. It's happening really soon. We're really looking forward, town's looking forward to that being the cornerstone of downtown. And I really, when we're talking about community, it seems like that's the theme for tonight's meeting. Mm-hmm. Is that's really going to be the new community meeting center. And something that people, you know, we have a senior center, but we haven't had a real community meeting place. Like you said, with the three new rooms, it's going to be just wonderful. And seeing the way that you're making the temporary space work, I can't imagine how wonderful it's going to be moving to the new one. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That's very exciting.
You guys are very well read, I can tell. You present extremely well. Well-read people present extremely well. It was a great presentation, and I, for one, am really excited to see the library moving along. I've been in the construction business in different ways for many, many years, so I'm watching the steel and looking for the electrical stuff and a few other things to go in there. And I'd encourage you guys to get by there, too. I think if we could, once it becomes a little bit safer to move around, I think you guys being familiar with how it's being built, mm-hmm. and how it's going up will help you sort of visualize what's coming down the path for the library and can probably help us as we put the library up too. So don't be shy about going in there. Get with Dave Del Torio, the town engineer, through the town manager or whomever, and I'd get a hard hat. But I'd make yourselves available to go over there and check it out. You know, it's going to be what you're going to have to be overseeing hopefully for a long time. And I encourage you to get out there and participate in that process, too. But great job tonight, and thank you for coming in.
Thanks very much for having us.
Have a good night.
You too.
Take care.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Thanks, you too.
Thank you.
Okay, next up on the agenda, and we're just a few minutes early, but I think we have most of the individuals gathered that we wanted to gather for this discussion. Mr. Kamalo, if you would be so kind as to help us get ready for this. We're going to, again, utilize the new format of our meeting room and roll up another table so that we can have more of our colleagues join us for this discussion. It'll just take a minute. So we're going to take a two-minute recess, but we'll stay right here with HCAM. If anybody needs to jump up for a minute.
You want me to have a mic? All right, I'll sit here and then you sit there. How's that? Hey, please feel free to join the table. Ken, everybody sit around the table. We have space.
Everybody gets to participate.
Ken is sitting there.
Huh?
I was trying to encourage Ken to.
Voice man on 145 yeah. Ash.
And it take cool.
Yeah. Okay. Connor's here, right?
Everybody's here.
How's it going?
I'm well. How are you?
Doing very well, thank you.
Thank you all for coming tonight. I think we lost him to a cell phone, so we'll catch up with him in a minute. So why don't we start with the election results? Do we have the hard numbers or very close to the hard numbers?
I sent you the I sent the entire board.
You did,
yeah. Official results and they are posted down on the bulletin board and up on the town website.
So you know what, let me back up for a second. So this is item number 9 on the Board of Selectmen agenda for tonight, and we have it titled Recreational Marijuana Discussion. And that's really all this is an introduction and a discussion we're going to have here for maybe a half hour about recreational marijuana, the new state law, and just get some ideas and thoughts going about it. We are making no decisions about anything tonight. It is very premature to even start thinking about what we can do, what we can't do, should we do something, should we not do something. All that will come down the road, but we thought we would just introduce the concept tonight and kind of take it from there a little bit. So with that, statewide, question four, right?
Yep.
Passed. I don't know the numbers statewide, roughly, percentage-wise.
I don't know off the top of my head. I know that it was one of the closer votes of the question in Hopkins, and only off by maybe 100 or so. It was a very close vote percentage-wise, but I believe it probably drove a lot of turnout as well.
Mm. So I think statewide is around 55-45 for supporting question 4 and allowing recreational marijuana in some form across the Commonwealth. And they're going to have to figure out what all those regulations are in the coming months.
Failed in Hopkins.
In Hopkinton, I thought it failed in Hopkinton. Yeah, so in Hopkinton, I believe it failed. Very close. It was very close. To your point, Connor, it was very, very close, but it didn't pass in Hopkinton. Now, that doesn't mean that we're going to say, all right, well, the state Commonwealth said yay, but Hopkinton says no, so you know, we run our own show around here because we may not be able to do anything about that. But I think, and Mr. Kamal and I talked about this is going to be an issue that a lot of people are going to have opinions on, and this is going to be an issue that could stir a little bit of passion. So the sooner the better to start a healthy dialogue about what's going on, I think puts us all in a better place. So why don't we do this? I don't know if the camera is not really picking up on everybody in the room. There's no way to kind of back out to everybody, is there? There we go. That's great. That's perfect. So and I'm just loving this new room. This is working really well. This is why we did this. We wanted everyone to be able to sit down and have a conversation together about different issues. So this is exciting for us. So why don't we do this real quick? Let's go around the table and just introduce ourselves and say who we are and what we do for those that are watching, just so they understand, because we do have some guests at the table with unfamiliar faces to some in town, not to us, but to others in town. Mrs. Wright, we obviously know who you are.
Clay Wright.
Ted Stone. Denise.
Denise Hildreth, Director of Youth
and
Family Services.
Connor Town Clerk.
Ed Wertman, Director of Public Health.
Ibrea Freed, Associate Town Council.
Raymie Yars, Town Council.
The Town Council.
The Ohio State University.
The you.
Ed Lee, Chief Hopkins Police Department.
Steve Slamon, Fire Chief, Emergency Management Director.
Jay Golfi, Director of Parks and Recreation.
Dan Lazarus, Director of Land Use and Town Operations.
Norman Kumano, Town Manager.
The Town Manager.
Ken Weissmantle, Chairman of the Planning Board.
Okay, great.
We're not missing anybody that we thought would join us tonight, are we?
No.
Okay. So, Mr. Meares, why don't we start with Town Council? Can you tell us where we are today in the Commonwealth with the passage of this law, in very broad terms? We don't have to get into the weeds here too much. And sure. Where you think this is headed over the next few months.
So, where I think it's headed over the next few months, so the ballot question, as you say, passed, that creates a statute which is holds the same level of importance as a statute passed by the legislature and signed by the governor. So this is a statute that creates CCC, the Cannabis Control Commission, which will be writing regulations for implementing this statute. Some of the key features of the statute are that it will go into effect on December 15th. At that time, it will be legal to grow marijuana in small quantities in your on your personal property. The statute has a number of provisions that affect the town's ability to control businesses that are engaged in marijuana, some aspect of the marijuana trade. So there are retail establishments, grow establishments, processing establishments. There is a provision that allows towns to continue to prohibit various types of facilities if they wish to do so. It appears that such a prohibition would require both a town meeting vote and a ballot question. I say it appears because this is not the cleanest statute we've ever seen. There are a number of questions about how it's to be interpreted. And depending on what you want to do under the statute, we would advise when a provision is susceptible of interpretation in multiple ways that we take the most conservative. So right now, there is a provision in the statute that says that any zoning bylaw that seeks to prohibit a type of facility must be passed by a vote of the voters. We're going for now to interpret that to mean but a ballot question, although most statutes that call for a ballot question are much more explicit when they say there's going to be a ballot question, and most of them, in fact, say the form of the question should be this. The statute doesn't say that in this particular provision. So we're jumping to a bit of a conclusion. I understand that the Attorney General's office is not going to be providing us with any guidance. So as we move ahead, we'll learn when the Attorney General starts to approve or disapprove bylaws. A number of towns are already contemplating adopting zoning changes that would prohibit certain categories of facilities. Many others are considering moratoria, which is similar to what we did with medical marijuana a few years ago. We put into place a temporary hold in the hopes that in that case, the Department of Public Health would come up with regulations that would guide us. The CCC does not, that's the Cannabis Control Commission. The CCC does not yet exist. That is, no one has been appointed to it, but they are required to have regulations in place by September. By September, and to start accepting applications for marijuana licenses in November. October, she says. Okay, October. The
the licensing process is a state licensing process. That is, licenses aren't issued by you. So the town's ability to control this is primarily through the adoption of a bylaw of some sort. Our recommendation is not that if the town is interested in doing something proactive about it, that it's not dilly-dally. If there's going to be a zoning change, it should, or a moratorium, it should be expedited so that it's ready for adoption at the spring town meeting.
Okay. So one of the reasons we wanted to get together to start this discussion is to that very point. If we're going to try, and I'm not saying we are, and I don't want anybody to read into our meeting tonight or anything we say tonight, because this is just a discussion. No one's going to take any votes about anything. But we've got to, if we're interested in looking at this thing seriously and having a say in what goes on in our community, you know, we need to be ready for a May town meeting. So then you need to start formulating ideas through the Zoning Advisory Committee or the Planning Board or the Selectmen, wherever it's going to originate from, now to start to massage that process and get it ready for a spring town meeting. So I think it's timely that we're doing this, even though the election was just a couple weeks ago. Okay, anything else from the town council's chair?
If I may, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Kamal.
In terms of when the town could bring whatever decision is made to town meeting, I would suggest that rather than saying the annual town meeting, I think we should say at the earliest possible opportunity. I say that because the town is contemplating a special town meeting early part of the year.
Early part of the year in conjunction with the charter work that's required per the charter.
That is correct.
All right. Fair enough.
And the one other thing is that you also do have the option of adopting limits on the number of licenses that can be issued in your town. So rather than...
We do or the state does?
You do. That is, the town does. No. And so you can... Rather than just prohibit it, you can adopt a bylaw, for example, that restricts the number of licenses that can be issued.
Will there be growing licenses and retail licenses and consumption licenses, or is the consumption automatic? It's just the growing and the retail?
So consumption can occur in a private residence on December 15th. The town cannot prohibit that. Right now, on-premise consumption in a public place, for example, like a smoke shop, is prohibited. There is a provision in the statute which will allow a community through a vote of the voters, we assume through a ballot initiative, to allow for on-premise consumption. But right now, the only on-premise consumption that can occur is within a private residence.
Okay. And is there an age restriction similar to alcohol at the state level, or?
Yes.
21.
21, okay. What other sort of general things do we need to know about the law that can help us sort of start to think, you know, where we want to go, if anywhere?
Well, we're not sure where we are on, it's unclear. Like, yes, you have to consume in the home, but if they do it out in public, we don't have any statutes or anything for actual enforcement of it, even a minor. So this is all stuff. It's going to be a learning curve to us. Hopefully, some of the same restrictions as minors in possession of alcohol or public consumption or things of that nature. But right now, it's very vague what our enforcement capabilities will be.
It's vague in terms of enforcement, but the law states 21 and older.
Yes.
That's right.
So, I mean, from one person's perspective, I don't care what adults do in their lives. That's just my personal opinion here. Adults can do what they want. That's I've long believed that, and people make their individual choices. But what we message to our children is what I worry about. And that's really kind of where I'm going to come at this whole thing from, is what are we messaging to our children? I was saying that before the vote was taken, the day of the election, and to this day, that's going to be my thing. So I just want to be clear that 21 and older is the law. Mm-hmm. 21 and older is what Hopkinton will expect, whatever it is that we sort out. Anything under that, we're going to enforce, the rules that whatever they are, like we would enforce the rules specific to alcohol consumption or anything else. That for kids, it's a much different discussion.
Brian, I have a question.
Go ahead. Why don't we go to Mr. Ted Stone first, then we'll come back over to Ed. Yeah.
So with alcohol, it's easy to regulate because they generally come in cans of beer, bottles of wine. Cigarettes are easy to figure out because they come in cigarettes. But marijuana comes in, and again, I'm on the same mindset with you. If you're 21 years old, and you want to do what you want to do, do what you want to do. But with children, where they can, I know that in Colorado they've run into some problems where they've made marijuana look like a nice Christmas cookie, and a kid goes over and eats the cookie. Is there a way that we can regulate how this marijuana is going to be you can't regulate it at your home if you're going to grow marijuana and make it into an angel food cake. That's up to you. But are we going to have a 7-Eleven on the corner selling marijuana, in its leaf form and in baked goods and in the oils and things like that? That's my question. Is I hate to think about not just my children but all the children that start getting involved by walking by the counter and grabbing a cookie or brownie or whatever, and all of a sudden they're falling down the stairs. That's a real concern that I have.
So I would say that all of those kinds of questions are going to be regulated at the state level by the CCC, and we should assume, until the CCC tells us otherwise, that they have the authority to regulate the packaging and the labeling and all of those things, and that we do not. So the town's authority is really going to be limited to controlling the number of facilities it allows or prohibiting them, adopting zoning prohibitions.
Okay. Ed was eager, and then we'll come back to the chief.
I was just going to say, Mr. Chairman, that at least we have a prohibition already in the town bylaws on public property. But as Brandon mentioned, the dilemma our department has is the food code that we enforce includes the federal food code, which has an illegal prohibition on any illegal substances. So if you were trying to eat marijuana, that would violate the federal food code for any of the food establishments that we have.
Okay. Okay. Chief.
Yeah, I had an opportunity to get back to Mr. Tedson's point of view on the consumption and use and everything. I had the opportunity to speak with a chief of a local town in Colorado. He actually addressed several Massachusetts chiefs of police, and he pretty much said, gentlemen, look out, you got a storm coming. Just a couple quick statistics. In the last 2 years since they legalized it, 49% of an increase of 49% of ER responses, traffic deaths, 48% increase in 2 years. In fact, 20% of all fatalities in Colorado right now involve marijuana. Now, the problem for us, we're obviously going to see an increase of impaired drivers on the road because of the legalization, whether it's adults or juveniles, and what we're facing right now is there's no real test there's no, like a breathalyzer for alcohol, there's no test for marijuana. That being the case, we have to, take steps in order to prosecute. Now, what's available now is observations. And the only thing, you have to specially train an officer called DRE, Drug Recognition Expert. And there's only a handful in the state. I think there's 30 for all of Massachusetts State Police. We happen to have one in Hopkinton, but to share that responsibility, first it costs an incredible amount of money to train these people. That's something that the Mass Chiefs are working on. But even when you have a DRE, you still have a very, very high acquittal rate on these cases just based on observations. So, that was the big push by the Mass Chiefs. Unfortunately, passed. Nothing we can do about that. I am proud of the fact that we did. I guess it didn't pass in Hopkinton, and I contribute that to the education of my colleagues, especially Denise, and work with the Hopkinton Prevention Coalition to get that message out. But like you say, Mr. Chair, we certainly have to continue on getting that message out and the dangers that are going to come with this thing that's been forced upon us.
Let's go back to the numbers again. Connor, I think the numbers, just you're clarifying that.
Yeah, so the vote was of the total of 9,336 voters that voted in the state election. In Hopkinton, 4,814 voted no on question four, while 4,444 voted yes, with 78 people not voting on the question.
So a 400-person difference?
Yeah. So it was a close one, but I think it showed what a majority of Hopkinton voters were looking for out of that, which, at the very least, I would say would lean towards making sure that it's regulated just to the point where residents can feel safe. But I think I heard a lot of concerns, primarily with driving under the influence. That was the biggest concern that I heard from voters and from other residents throughout the period of the elections and before that. Mm.
Okay. Mr. Catino. So
my concern comes into how poorly the statute's written.
Not my fault.
and the guidance we're really going to need from town council, because as we talked about before, if people know that one drink per hour is about what it takes for the average size person to be able to be somewhat sober. But how does one regulate at this point, knowing how many THC infused candies they can eat, or brownies, or smoking? And is smoking marijuana not allowed where there's no smoking? I'm surprised at how strong the lobby was to get rid of cigar bars in the last 10 years, because they had to have enough alcohol consumed when one was at one of these, and they just were just basically put out of business. And now we're coming along with this statute basically legalizing it, but with nothing behind it. And it's just one of those unfunded mandates uncontrolled mandates that are coming down. It's really putting a lot of pressure on how we're going to control it. So it's a shame that we're in that position.
Jay?
To follow up on that, and maybe this is a question for council, any difference between organic marijuana and synthetic marijuana? Because I've heard some pretty horrible stories about, especially with teenagers, and synthetic marijuana, that it's really not marijuana at all. But does anyone know what I'm talking about? My chief concern is the one facility where I tend to each year see potential problems is at the beach, where people tend to, there, if we do have issues with alcohol consumption, that's where we tend to have it for whatever reason. My concern is when you have synthetic marijuana or any sort of a hallucinogen in water, we open ourselves up to a potentially awful situation.
Okay. Mrs. Wright.
A comment and a question. It did not pass in Hopkinton. It was close. But I still maintain that just because many Hopkinton voters voted that they wanted to make it legal in Massachusetts or available somewhere in the state does not necessarily mean that those people want to have it in Hopkinton. Those are not necessarily equal. We have only a couple of concentrated commercial centers. The downtown, there's kids all over the place. And then it's the Lumber Street area. So, you know, in terms of the way our commercial areas are laid out, they're very concentrated and they're very few. But I just wanted to ask Ray, I'm feeling like I don't like the idea of even having this in town anywhere, but you mentioned limiting permits. Now, under alcohol, the number of alcohol licenses are pegged to the population, which is produced with the census every 10 years. Again, sounds like everything is in the works here. Any guidance as to how many a community could permit, or is it wide open?
The key is 20%. The key difference is 20% of the number of alcohol licenses that you have authorized. If you want to reduce below 20% of the So the number of licenses that we have is we don't know a number.
Let's say it's 10.
So it's not a maximum.
20%.
If you want to adopt a restriction, you can. But if you want to adopt a restriction that's below 20% of the number of licenses you have, then that requires a vote of the voters.
So if we had 10, we would theoretically have to allow two?
Right now, you don't have any restriction on the number. You can adopt a restriction on the number, but you haven't done it yet, obviously.
So we could adopt a restriction that said we would like to have zero.
You can do that. It would require, we believe, a ballot question.
So in effect, we would basically put the ballot question back on the ballot for Hopkinton only, correct?
That's right. So you do there.
That was 2/3.
It appears that the statute contemplates four kinds of facilities. That would be growing facilities, manufacturing facilities, testing facilities, and retail facilities. And if you were adopting a prohibition, it says you can prohibit types of facilities. So I believe that if you wanted it to be a blanket prohibition against all four, you would have to specifically name all four.
Okay, so you named four types of things that the law addresses. But
yeah,
I'm still
again,
not
I
clear
say,
about it, the consumption piece. We just had a very responsible pub owners here a few minutes ago, and we changed the manager. Can somebody walk into Cornell's on December 20th and light a joint?
No.
Can they do that next year sometime?
No.
Only if you adopt a bylaw that authorizes it.
So we could, if we adopted a bylaw locally to allow for public consumption in a private business,
yes,
that would be allowed.
That's right.
If I may, but we don't allow smoking bars anymore. So is this going to now open up that you can open like cigarettes and cigars and bars?
No. If the town votes to allow for on-premise consumption, the on-premise consumption must occur in a marijuana retail establishment. So they couldn't smoke marijuana in a bar. They can only smoke it where they're buying it. If you adopt through a vote of the voters on-premise consumption.
Could they ingest it?
It's on-premise consumption.
Consumption, I think, means that. Yes.
Yeah, and just to
so I want to be clear too. Cornell's has nothing to do. I'm sorry, I even used that name in this discussion. You are not allowed to go to Cornell's and do whatever it is we're talking about.
And just to clarify, there are the four types of licenses that Ray just described. But we look at those as sort of like umbrella categories. It's anticipated that the CCC will promulgate regulations within that. So there may be multiple types of retail establishments like we have for alcohol, all alcohol or wine or beer only. So one thing that's being tossed around is the possibility that there will be a retail establishment for baked goods license and a retail establishment for, you know, leaf marijuana. So eventually down the road, we could see something like that where you could prohibit just baked goods, that type, or limit just that type. You know, there may be more flexibility as the regulations come forward. We just don't know.
So to be clear, the statute allows you to prohibit prohibit types of facilities, but didn't define anywhere what constitutes a type. So we're guessing, as sort of a baseline, is since there appear to be four kinds of licenses, license categories, that those might be the types. But the CCC might decide that they're, you know, going to be, they're going to recognize other types or subtypes, and that will become the categories that you will be addressing.
To that point.
Hang on one sec. Mr. Kamal.
To that point, Ray, what I'm hearing so far is that as written, the ballot question would allow the town to prohibit consumption, i.e., you cannot, the town can prohibit the establishment of a marijuana bar. So I'm not using Cornell's, marijuana bar. However, I don't believe the statute allows the town to prohibit the establishment of a marijuana package store.
No, what do you think? No, I think that's, I think they can. Mm-hmm. And indeed, I'm not sure marijuana bars are.
No, again, the marijuana bars would only occur if a town voted to allow for on-premise consumption, and that consumption must occur in a retail, marijuana retail establishment. So that's, a lot of things would have to happen for that to occur. But right now, a town, through a vote of the voters, could prohibit or limit the amount of marijuana shops if they wanted to.
Mr. Tino.
Or prohibit, yes.
I'm sorry, let me get this and we'll come back to it.
Mr. Mears, can we use the medical marijuana bylaw that we wrote as any guidance as to location and any of that? Does that have any bearing, or is that moot at this point?
Not moot. Our medical marijuana zoning bylaw designates certain districts where medical marijuana facilities are permitted. And I don't see that there is any problem with adopting a zoning bylaw that says marijuana, recreational marijuana facilities are permitted in the same zones or a subset of all zones. Because you're not limiting the number of licenses that can be issued. I think that would be perfectly permissible. But you can't just say that the existing bylaw covers it because it doesn't.
No, I understand that.
And indeed, there's one way to read the existing zoning bylaw is any place that a retail establishment, for example, is allowed, a marijuana retail establishment is allowed, and any place that manufacturing is allowed, a marijuana manufacturing operation is allowed.
So I'd like to kind of...
That's not the result you want. A change will be needed.
I'd like to try and sort of bring us back up to maybe 10,000 feet and talk a little bit more about the politics.
You're trying to get us
up high. I didn't want to say I was going to bring us up high. The politics of the question and the issue before us. At a 52-48 or a 53-48, I thought it was about a 5% differential there. And maybe not in the land of Massachusetts politics, but in the land of U.S. politics, that's a 5% win. That's a pretty big win, actually. Some would argue that's a mandate. I mean, people love to talk about the mandate right after elections about certain things. I think it's a pretty strong message that the town didn't support question four. Did a bunch of people support question four? Yes, a good chunk of people. But it wasn't a clear majority supporting it. There was a clear majority against it. And I think that's sort of the first thing that I kind of come back to as we talk about this is, do we as a community really want to go down this path? I'm not sensing from the community that we do. I'm sure I will get emails and comments specific following tonight's meeting from those that do, and I understand their position and they have a right to it. But our job, at least my job as I view it, is to understand the general will and the common good of Hopkinton. And a 53-48 or a 52-48, even if it's a 4% number, for someone that's tried politics at the statewide level a couple of times, that's a hard number to achieve. So I think Hopkinton has a message there. And that's where I'm kind of interested in starting this discussion with the community. If the community proves me wrong at the ballot box and it turns 60-40 that they want to go forward with certain things, then that's okay too. And we'll deal with that. But I don't think that's the starting point. And I guess from my seat anyway, just as one member, not as a chair, I'd like to start to explore ways to figure out how we can limit or put a moratorium or strictly manage this law at the state level in Hopkinton. And I'm not hearing anybody sitting, we're not making decisions tonight, but I'm not hearing anyone sitting around the table, either elected or appointed or professional team members and colleagues, arguing a different position than what I just articulated. Mr. Kamal.
If I may add to your point, I think Brian and the community, the legal steps that the town can take should be one part of a comprehensive strategy. I think what I'm hearing from the police chief is that there are other social impacts that the town has to address, and I'm sure if we give Dennis the floor, he will also raise that issue. So I'm encouraging us to continue to think holistically, address the legal issues, and also pay attention to the immediate social impacts that this community will face.
Okay. Mr. Weissman.
First of all, I think it's kind of interesting. I'm sitting with a plaque behind me that says we're the highest town in Middlesex, which is not true by elevation-wise. Maybe we will be, depending on where we go on this particular issue. My question is for Ray. If we would do a moratorium similar to what we did with the recreational marijuana and allow things to kind of settle out around us and figure out where things are going, do we also need a vote of the voters to do a moratorium for a year?
I talked to the Attorney General's office, the head of the Municipal Law Unit, about this very question on Friday, because we need to know the answer. She said that she believes that just like when we were dealing with medical marijuana, that her office disapproved prohibitions but approved moratoriums, finding that a moratorium was not a prohibition. She believes that that is the same rule that they would apply this time around. So what that seems to say is that you could adopt a moratorium just by a town meeting vote and not also require a ballot question. You may have noticed that I keep throwing in weasel words. It seems to mean this, and that's because nobody's done this yet, and so we don't have any precedent for any to rely on. We're mostly just giving educated guesses, but that seemed to be her view, at least on Friday, and so I believe that's probably true. Now, if you, it isn't to say that it might not be a good idea to throw in the ballot question as well, but it appears as though you can do a moratorium without one.
I think the reason I bring it up is I'm sensing there's a lot of confusion with this whole issue going on and how we want to proceed as far as zoning aspect is going to take, not necessarily, I'll say the zoning advisory committee is already looking at it, planning board will look at it after they make a recommendation. But I think all the other options and how you might regulate it, et cetera, if you wanted to do that, those are completely unclear at this point. And I know we have the special town meeting coming up for the charter issues. We might want to think right now the fallback position is a moratorium at that particular meeting for sure, and start at least going down that way unless we decide we're going to veer off to the right or the left some other way. But start with maybe that as the baseline, and then give us ourselves some time to let the world figure out, or the rest of the state figure out, what bounds we can do things with. Hmm.
Does anyone have anything else they want to add to the discussion before we try to put a wrap on, at least for tonight? Denise?
So, appreciating what everybody has said, I have very serious concerns about what legalization is going to be in Massachusetts. You know, although the question was about, you know, folks over 21 can now use marijuana, what we know from Colorado is that teen use increased by 20% after legalization. So we're going to see an increase in teen use. And I think the passage of the law, unfortunately, sends the message that marijuana use is harmless. And marijuana use, in fact, can be really problematic for a lot of families. And I work with a number of those families. So not only from the perspective of that it's a gateway drug, so most of the folks that I work with who are using heroin and opioids and have really fallen into some really serious addiction issues start with marijuana or alcohol or the things that seem much more harmless. That's not to say that everybody that uses marijuana or alcohol are going to be addicted to heroin, but the folks that become addicted to heroin most often start with marijuana and or alcohol. So, and beyond that, there are a number of families who, and I met with some of them a week ago, for whom just marijuana use has become a real challenge for their kids, where kids are stuck with emotional issues, academic problems, employment problems that really are centered around just marijuana use. So I think, unfortunately, we're sending the message that we're normalizing marijuana use as something that doesn't cause anybody problems, and it can cause people problems. So there's that I'm concerned about. We're certainly going to see an increase in teen marijuana use as a result of this. That's going to bring about lots of social-emotional issues, as Roman was talking about. The use of edibles is a whole different kind of game changer because edibles are metabolized differently than smoking. And folks that have never taken an edible are going to see an impact that feels quite different from smoking, that has a delayed reaction. People will then take more, maybe smoke on top of it. That's how we end up with ER emissions. You don't know how much is in that part of the brownie that you ate. So there's a whole host of issues that are going to be brought to bear as a result of this that will impact adolescents, even though the law is not for adolescents, right? It's for adults. So I think we do have to be really thoughtful about not only how we regulate it, but also how we educate folks around marijuana and the challenges of marijuana use that can have some serious implications for families.
Okay. So it's an issue where we're going to hear feedback from citizens pro and con for legalization, against legalization. The vote has been taken at the state level. The town of Hopkinton is not going to sort of annex itself, just run off and create its own little state here. We're going to follow state law, but state law does allow for certain things to take place in local communities till we get our heads around things and get organized and understand what we do or don't want to do as we move forward as a community. So we'll follow state law. We'll work with the Attorney General's office. We'll do everything according to, following the wishes of the Massachusetts voter, but also following the wishes of the Hopkinton voter as best we can. And I think that's going to create a little bit of a dynamic that we have to sort through in the coming weeks and months. But we need to get on it. So my question is, where's the best way to start looking at this? Is it at the Board of Selectmen level? Is it at the Planning Board level? Is it with the Zoning Advisory Committee? Where should we start to look, or is it still sit with you until you figure out where you think we should go?
No, I'm happy to pass it along. To me, the important thing to keep in mind is the December 15th date. So if there is going to be either a moratorium or something stronger that's going to be put before town meeting in the spring, either at the special or at the annual. You want the planning board to notice its public hearing before December 15th. That's not a long time away from now. And normally our notices of public hearings include a text.
So what's that December 15th date specific to again?
That is the date that the new statute goes into effect.
So if we notice prior to that, then we've got ourselves
that means that if we have, if then the zoning change that ultimately gets adopted, it will be effective for all permits retroactive to the date of that notice. So the reason why that's important is because, as things stand right now, somebody can come in on December 16th to the building inspector's office and ask for a building permit to issue to build one of these facilities. And even though they don't have a license, they can get a building permit, and that facility would be grandfathered. So that's what you're trying to avoid.
So whether the planning board would act on it or not, I don't know, because the planning board is a duly elected independent board in the town of Hopkinton. But could town council draft a specific notice that you would suggest that the planning board consider prior to a December 15th adoption of the other rules?
Yes.
That the planning board could then consider and take into advisement, under advisement, and perhaps take a vote on.
And what sort of a bylaw do you have in mind?
So this is where we weren't going to make any decisions part comes into play.
Well, we have 3 weeks. Okay.
23 days.
What is your next meeting?
Well, he's talking about the planning board. It's got to be a planning board vote.
We need to notice that, don't we? Is this a public hearing?
It doesn't have to be.
No, you don't have the public hearing. You have to decide on when the public hearing is going to be, but that doesn't have to be by December 15th. You just have to publish the notice by December.
Okay.
But the notice, typically our notices say, you know, we're noticing a proposed bylaw. The text is available at the town clerk's office. So it'd be nice if we had some text. And in order to have text, it would be nice if we had some idea what you're looking for. If you're looking for a moratorium, that's one thing. If you're looking for something stronger, that might take a little bit.
Moratorium's the easiest one because we don't know really the other part of it. So I'd start at least there.
I wouldn't want to do what you said, if I may, Chair. When you said that the previously the Attorney General was approving moratoriums but not approving prohibitions. So I don't want to be I would want to be one of the people that says we're going to prohibit it. And then have it overturned, and then we missed the overturning point.
Okay, so there is a difference in that the statute actually does authorize towns to adopt prohibitions, whereas the medical marijuana did not. But it is a more complicated process because it involves a ballot question and. It certainly wouldn't be a difficult decision to say, well, maybe the first thing we want to do is go with the moratorium. That at least freezes everything, the current situation, until some of these other issues get resolved.
And this would be at the planning board level, not at the zoning advisory committee level, correct?
Well, the planning board usually works with the zoning advisory committee, but it's not essential.
It's not required by law either.
No.
That's just a subcommittee to the planning board.
That's
so
right.
I wouldn't want to add another layer of stuff that has to get done between now and December 15th, if that's what they decide to do, because we're not making decisions tonight. But if that's what the planning board, and it is a planning board issue, it's not a board of selectmen issue, correct?
Well, the zoning process, as you know, is supposed to begin by a referral of a zoning. A proposed zoning amendment from the Board of Selectmen to the Planning Board. That is nominally the way that zoning amendments are supposed to happen. The Attorney General does not enforce that provision, and our tradition in Hopkinton is to have zoning changes originate either at ZAC or at the Planning Board.
Planning Board.
I think it's fine to skip that provision here as well because the Attorney General doesn't really enforce it. But nominally, it's supposed to begin with you. But in this case, we don't have a huge amount of time. So if the planning board wants to act on its own motion, I think that would be fine.
Okay, so we've had a couple of hands go up here in the last minute. I didn't get to everybody. Who else was trying to jump in on something here? Chief?
Just quickly, almost like a public service announcement, and I had some concerns from all questions, and one of them was, will your police officers be smoking marijuana after December 15th? And the answer is absolutely no. There is a policy that I'll be putting out before there that outlines specific reasons why they cannot. One, it's still a Schedule One drug under federal law, and an officer to partake in that would be subject to violations of the rules and regulations and a possible charge of conduct unbecoming. Two, the federal law prohibits people that partake in marijuana for any use, even medical. They're not allowed to purchase firearms, or they're not allowed to purchase ammunition. So an officer who's not allowed to purchase a firearm or carry a firearm then would obviously not be able to be a police officer. The same thing goes, too, and we'll be educating people who have, I have a great, a big responsibility in this town with issuing and licensing permits, and that federal law still holds true for people that if they're a known marijuana person uses, they fall under the same guidelines. So we certainly do our best to educate people when they apply for an LTC or any other firearms license, and we'll continue to educate the public on that.
Okay. Connor, you had a question.
Yes. Through you, I was curious if possibly town council will be able to answer this question. If the statute in its current form in a procedure of enforcing the use specifically with people who are under the age of 21, would the non-criminal violations still apply to those individuals who are not protected by how the statute works currently?
Well, that's an interesting question. So what he's referring to is that, you know, we already have two marijuana statutes on the books, one that allows medical marijuana, which we've talked about, but the other one is the decriminalization statute that that was adopted a few years ago that allows police officers to issue essentially tickets for marijuana use. I would assume, although I don't know that this was contemplated in the statute, I would assume that those tickets were still are still available to be used to enforce the age 21 restriction. But I have not heard anybody else raise that question, so it's a new one.
Assumption as well, you think?
Yes. So we have on the books already a prohibition against public consumption of marijuana, and I don't see that it's that's affected by this statute.
Okay. Any other, Mr. Kamal?
A couple of other thoughts. I think in addition to a town council looking into the zoning bylaw, there are a couple of other areas of interest for me, at least from a management perspective. One, we do have an employee handbook that references substance abuse. So it'll be interesting to have a conversation with you and Nick in terms of what the legalization of recreational marijuana means in that regard. And then secondly, I think we also need to assure the public that in terms of our DPW employees, holding a CDL license comes along with a prohibition of the use of marijuana. My understanding is that will continue to be in place. We have employees who operate heavy equipment, and we want to make sure that they don't do so under the influence of marijuana.
I'll share that policy with you, Norman, because it does address two. It does the law does not supersede workplace policies that prohibit that. So I think we're good, and that's what that policy is based on, workplace law and federal law.
Well, if that's a provision in the new law that's coming forward and the regulations that are coming forward, that's a huge education piece for all the employees of the town of Hopkinton.
So
is that there, because the Commonwealth of Massachusetts adopted this new law, does not change the rules for the local community and those driving, you know, town-owned assets, et cetera, et cetera. We got to be very, very careful and make sure people understand that piece.
Okay, so in terms of and specifically the statute, Section 2E, and this chapter shall not require an employer to permit or accommodate conduct otherwise allowed by this chapter in the workplace, and shall not affect the authority of employers to enact and enforce workplace policies restricting the consumption of marijuana by employees. And the next F, negligent conduct, this chapter shall not amend existing penalties for conduct involving the performance of any task while impaired by marijuana that would constitute negligence or professional malpractice, and shall not prevent the imposition of any civil, criminal, or other penalty for such conduct. So all the driving rules about not driving under the influence are not amended by this.
Yeah. Okay. So, but in that regard, I don't want to lose sight of the 2 points that Ed raised. I think it would be helpful for us to be better educated in terms of how the town can take advantage of the two laws that Ed mentioned.
Okay. So it is running late, folks. We've got a couple of things we need to address as a board, so I'd like to try and wrap this discussion up for this evening anyway. I think we've got some good input from everyone at the table, specifically from town council relative to some dates that are coming up and some actions that duly elected members of the community might want to consider. Right. So with that, if town council in the next couple of days could advise those that might be taking a vote about it, what they should or should not look at as quickly as possible, I think that would be helpful. And frankly, I think that's the general will of the community at this point, specific to this question. Does that make sense?
Maybe not the next couple of days. There is a holiday coming up, you know. But yes, it does make sense. When does the planning board meet next?
The 5th?
I don't remember. I think it's
the
9th of December, or is that the 1st or 5th? Have 2 meetings in December.
5th. December 5th.
December 5th.
5th. 5th, yeah.
Okay. Well, that gives us that's a manageable amount of time.
So are you good with that?
So good with that.
General discussion and perhaps some action items that might take place. Right? Everybody else good for now?
Mm-hmm. Okay. It's good that this whole group, everyone seems to be on the same mindset. Yeah. I think that speaks volumes.
That's a lot.
Okay, great. Okay. Thank you all for coming tonight. I appreciate it very much, and we'll talk soon. Okay, we're going to move on, folks, because I know we're running behind. My apologies. Item number 10, board liaison reports and any invites. Do we have any invites that anyone's aware of, Mr. Kamal and Ms. Lazarus, in the last few days? Last 2 weeks, actually.
At this point, we'll check with Maria.
Yeah, Mrs. Wright is mentioning the Holliston Joint Board of Selectmen meeting coming up in a couple weeks. That'll be an organized forum gathered, and then, you know, we'll have a meeting then.
Yeah, I cannot attend that, so I want to make sure that some of our board, someone is coming to represent the board. I thought I was.
Yeah.
Okay.
To that point, in fact, without speaking for Brian, I think Brian and I also will be at the school committee budget meetings on Thursdays.
So. All right, well, we'll have to get, when we get a little closer to that date, we'll figure out who can attend that meeting, because I thought we were going to be able to go to that and go to the school committee. No, we weren't going to be able to go to that.
It's crazy. Okay.
All right, we'll figure that out. So any liaison reports? Mr. Catino? Mrs. Wright?
Not really.
Mr. Tedstone?
I hit the elementary school building committee. That's obviously going great. You can see by driving down Hayden Row what a great job that is doing. The Veterans Celebration Committee, I went to two events. I went one with you and then one with Mr. Catino
Those both were running excellent. That's all I have.
Okay. I have been attending, or I've been to one school committee meeting specific to their budget process for FY18, and I've been to one or two chair, town manager, chair, superintendent, finance director meetings where we're just talking about the budget like we've all talked about it before, and we're starting to sort of advance some ideas. But we're going to the school committee meetings to listen to their budget presentations. They've invited us to sit at the table like we're doing here with everybody, and we are asking questions sort of inside their budgets, getting into some detail. They talked about, you know, adding, they need to do this and this, and they sound like great ideas. And then there was some discussion about adding a 0.6 administrative support position. And I raised my hand. I said, we're in a tight time here. I don't think that's going to message very well with the town. And they kind of sat there and said, yeah, okay, we understand. Thanks for the feedback. So they're listening, and we're having a good dialogue back and forth. But I've been to several of those types of meetings, and we're going to continue doing that in the month of December. So I'll keep you posted on that. Mr. Kamala, do you have any comments specific to the budget meetings and the process so far? Do we want to talk about the message and maybe some of the concern there, or you want to save that for another day?
Yeah, I think, though briefly, at our last meeting, we focused on how the respective town departments may implement the budget message that the selectmen articulated. I think one obvious challenge that became very clear during our discussions was the ability of town departments to meet the 2.5% tax impact, accounting for both the operational budget as well as the debt obligations that the town has approved. So we're continuing that discussion to see how we could address that constraint. We are scheduled to meet once every month, and we will meet as often as is possible. But again, I think the immediate challenge is how the town departments will accomplish the 2.5% tax impact.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anything else on liaison side? All right, Mr. Kamala, town manager's report, please.
Yes. Couple of items. Hayden Road traffic and safety update. Just wanted to share with the board that our town staff, working collaboratively with our colleagues from the schools, met a couple of weeks back, and we all acknowledged the issues that the community faces in terms of traffic safety on Hayden Road, and we decided on a two-pronged strategy. First off being, we need to bring the issue regarding finding the technical solutions to town meeting. So this is an issue that we brought before town meeting before. Our town meeting spoke back then. They felt we did not have adequate information to convince town meeting to make the necessary investments. And to that end, we came up with a second a component of the strategy, namely, we will look into our budgets, FY17 budgets, for money that we could pull together, both town and school, to bring in some technical assistance to defining the problem, and most importantly, engaging the community. So we have, on the school side, I'm happy to report that the superintendent brought the issue to the school committee, and at its last meeting, the school committee voted to approve $20,000 to be used towards that end. We're now doing the same on the town side, and what I'm specifically looking for from the selectmen tonight is your consensus view on allowing town staff to proceed with identifying whatever funds are available that we can apply to this process. Again, two-pronged strategy. We're coming back to town meeting, annual town meeting, to discuss the implementation of whatever measures are necessary to make Hayden Road a safer corridor. And then secondly, to that end, we want to begin a process to engage the community so that at least we can discuss the process, the solutions with the community.
Any thoughts on that topic, Mrs. Wright?
So is some of this money going to be spent on actual engineering studies as to what could be done to fix the problem?
Working collaboratively with the community, yes.
What do you mean by collaborative? I mean, are we going to get a product that we can actually act on and build, or are we just talking? I mean, I guess where I'm coming from with my question is it seems like the catalyst for this was that terrible accident that happened on Hayden Row, and Paul DeBona pulled together the big petition of people that are concerned about that real pressure point there. I have looked at that spot multiple times, and it appears that the driver did exactly what was supposed to be done, and that I couldn't even see what steps could have been taken to prevent someone who was just not paying attention. I mean, I guess I want to know, for the amount of money that's going to be spent, are we going to get something that we can act on, or are we just, is it going to be just a discussion? I'm not quite understanding what we're going to get for the money.
We will get something that the town meeting can act on.
Can we get something, though, that will comply with state regulations? Because we've talked about lowering the speed limit, doing some other stuff on that road a couple of times, and Mass DOT says that's our road, not yours.
Good thing is that law has now changed. I think our chances are good in terms of addressing that issue. We did discuss the role of the accident. Clearly, it was a reminder, unfortunately. However, from staff's perspective, this is an issue that goes beyond the accident. It's an issue that has been out there predating the accident. We have been committed to finding solutions to the corridor. What we're looking at is the stretch of the corridor from right in front of the schools, going all the way to is it Pleasant?
Chestnut.
Yeah, Chestnut. Sorry. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Chestnut. That we want to study that whole corridor.
Okay.
If I may, Mr. Chair, I think to Ms. Wright's statement, you can't engineer out of stupidity or ignorance. People weren't paying attention when they were driving. The first car stopped. The second car they must not have been paying attention. We have nothing to base that on, other than how hard they hit. No matter what we come up with engineering, other than lowering the speed limit, which may have just lowered the size of the impact, but if they're not paying attention,
there was no sight
there's distance. Nothing you can do other than having the cars equipped with the automatic braking.
Again, I hear your perspective. To be clear, our concern is not just that individual accident. We have looked at this issue previously. We want to look at the entire corridor. We want to see the impact of the increased traffic volumes. We want to look at the coordination of the different driveways going into the schools. So it goes beyond. The issue we want to address goes beyond the accident. Again, the accident was a reminder, unfortunately, but the impetus behind doing this project goes beyond the accident.
But what I want to know is, for that money at the end, are we going to get something that we can act on? Are we just going to get a study that's going to confirm what we already know? Yeah, you know, it's a problem. I mean, I don't want to spend that money on something that's going to be nothing but a study that just confirms something. I want one on something we can do something with, like, okay, let's build that.
Our goal is to get something that the town can act on. You will recall that the last attempt bringing this at town meeting was unsuccessful because we couldn't get a consensus behind the solution. That's why this time we want to make sure that before town meeting we engage the community in supporting whatever solution we bring to town meeting, namely something that the town can act on.
Hayden Row, from the schools to Chestnut Street, if not all the way to the Milford border, is now a neighborhood. There are houses lining both sides of that. There's even more now. Mm-hmm. And there is two streets, if not three. You know, one's almost done, another one's under construction, a new school's coming online right there. I mean, that's a neighborhood now. And it's a 40-mile-an-hour speed limit. Yeah. That's crazy. Mm-hmm. And when I've talked about this a couple of times over the years, it's always been the state says, sorry, state regulations say it's a 40-mile-an-hour zone, it's not going to change. And I've always said, that's crazy. We should be able to do something. If we can now do something because the law has changed, if at the very minimum, if we can get that to a lower speed limit, I think we're much further ahead of the game.
If this study that we get can give us the fodder that we need to bring to the state or bring to somebody to do it, then this is what's going to work. We can lower that speed limit.
Okay. And it hasn't just been that accident, which was an unfortunate accident. You're right, that driver just whatever. Well, that's what we think anyway. It's alleged, but we had the young man who lost his life a couple years ago. A very sad situation, and I mean, I work along there. There's all kinds of different things going on that road. I mean, I'm constantly hearing, you know, screeching and
drop off
situation, and I just think the overall density. So I'm all for trying to sort it out. I agree. We don't want to waste money at all, and you know, we want to be fiscally responsible at all times. But if we can make that a safer passage in Hopkinton, because it's become a neighborhood of the town now and not just the high, sort of the road, the highway through the center of town there, I'm all for it. And I know a lot of other people cut through from other towns and they're trying to get off 495, and well, if they have to go 25 on our road to get off 495 that's at a standstill, then that's what they have to do. Mm-hmm. So I don't think slowing it down is an inconvenience at all. I think it's a great first step. And maybe there's other things we can do too, some other kind of traffic controls and maybe tightening up a few of the roads or putting some of those things in that you see in a lot of other towns in front of schools, the big speed bumps, you know, not the thing like on...
Wow, I love that.
Yeah, but something, we'll figure that out, but something like that too. Anyway, any other thoughts on this topic from Mr. Kamalo? Do you need a vote on that?
Yes. In the past, the board has considered authorizing the town manager to work with town staff to find the funds in the current budget that could be used to move this.
The school committee voted that the other night, didn't they?
They've already put $20,000 on the table.
They put a vote together for it. Okay.
I do have just one more comment and observation. It's going to be a balancing act on the solution, because if we're going strictly on slowing the traffic down, if you recall, the reason the plan that was up before town meeting before failed was because the plan that was proposed, people felt was going to plug up the traffic even more. It's a very, very busy place during pickup time, and they had some lane change that was going to basically bring the traffic to a standstill, and people didn't want that. They're saying, we can't get through there now anyway. Don't make it worse. So it's going to be a push-pull between speed and the traffic. People still want the traffic to move. And if we go wholly on the speed issue, that may well fail as well because of the people that travel that every day that say, I can't even get through there now.
Well,
I think that's a good argument. It's going to be a balance.
But I think that's a good argument, actually, to spend the funds and get a real plan as to what would work.
Something that does both.
Because I don't think we necessarily had a real plan previously when we were at the town.
And I think it was the cost of the striping and everything also.
It was what it was going to do to the traffic backup. Anyway.
Okay. All right. So the chair will entertain a motion to support the town manager's request to seek funds in the current fiscal year not to exceed $20,000 to study and bring forward a plan to improve traffic safety and pedestrian safety along Route 85 from the schools to Chestnut Street.
Second.
Any further discussion? Mr. Kamal, are you okay with that motion?
25.
Sorry?
How about 25?
How about 20?
25.
Thank you.
I think we should match our colleagues at the school committee.
Yeah, I mean, I'm looking at this from the viewpoint that on the town side, we have public safety, we have engineering.
Yeah, we probably have a little more.
Yeah, we have more responsibility.
Okay, so who made the motion? Mr. Catino, what are your thoughts about the 25 and your motion?
Oh, let's try it with 20. They put 20. Let's try it with 20. Let's try it with 20.
Okay, we have 20 on the table, the motion and a second, correct? Any further discussion?
Let's fucking try.
Okay. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so
Thank you.
Let's, to his point, let's get it going. Let's see what works. See what happens. We'll go from there.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, next up, Mr. Kamal.
Yeah, the draft alcohol policy, I included a draft in your packet responding specifically to the comment from the board when the board last discussed this draft. Namely, Mr. Sestari asked us to identify if there were any potential license issues that may come up that currently were not covered in the bylaw, and here's what we found out. There are other licenses that are available that we could address in the policy, namely charity wine licenses, auctioneers licenses, package store auction licenses, pharmacist licenses, continuing care establishments licenses. I didn't realize that senior residences in town could apply for alcohol licenses. And so our suggestion is that we add those items to the list of issues that the policy could address.
And we're going to have a public hearing on this December 6th.
Yes, December 6th.
I don't see why we can't have those as part of that public hearing discussion.
Yeah.
Everybody okay?
Yep.
Makes sense.
Okay.
I'm not sure we'll go with all that, but we'll find out. Okay?
Thank you.
Anything else?
Nothing else.
And just back up real quick. You mentioned the different licenses, and it also states the camera policy.
Yeah, the camera policy, the board already looked at that and suggested that we include it in the draft policy.
Okay, so we'll take that back up then, too. I've gotten a lot of feedback about that.
There's no way I can't stress strongly enough how much I'm against.
Can I ask a question on that?
Sure.
Previously, Ray had sent us a memo where he said he thought that the inclusion of audio might bring it to a level of sophistication, i.e. expense, that put it, I mean, the enhanced video is one thing, but to include the audio was perhaps quite costly. Do we know, have we looked into what kinds of equipment is available and whether that adds a significant amount, or in this day and age where you can take a video with your phone, whether it's, is there a significant cost difference to include the audio?
We don't have the answer to that question yet. No. We will work with our police department and IT department to identify those costs.
Okay. Because the kind of feedback I've been getting is the impact on business owners, and there's obviously a balancing act between public safety and, you know, a burden on business owners. But if there's a significant cost difference between providing the audio and providing just the video, that might be worth taking into consideration as well.
If I may, for the chair, for me, it's privacy. It's the whole privacy issue. Who's controlling these files? You know, what's going to happen? How long are these files going to be held for? Who's going to hold them? You know, could somebody buying liquor end up on YouTube? Could they be part of a lawsuit, of a divorce hearing? Who controls these things? You know, the people working there, you know, they can't talk about their boss, they can't talk about overtime, they can't talk about anything. Their entire shift is being recorded, audio and video. I think that we're going after a problem. A saw to a problem that needs a scalpel, and really, I just think we're going way overboard with this, and the privacy issues are just, you know, they're not even they're talking about the expense that comes to the few liquor stores that we have in town. We only had a couple incidences, and we're going, I believe, way overboard, and we have no control over any of these files. And because this is just like the mandate that came down from the state, that they're saying, okay, you're going to have to do marijuana, and there's nothing behind it. We don't know what's going to happen with any of this stuff when we're saying we want to do this. So that just throwing that out there. So.
Okay, so we're going to discuss this on the 6th, and we have our public hearing, and that'll be part of that discussion. So I would suggest we table any further debate until we get to that point.
I'm good with that.
Okay. Anything else, Mr. Kamal?
Nothing else to report other than, again, to commend the library staff for a great job. I mean, Deb came in to help us on an interim basis. She's a town resident. We've managed to stretch her tenure, and I think we're getting real value. The returns are huge. Just think of how they have managed to increase their numbers in terms of usage, when in fact they're in a temporary location. That's great. And I'll tell you, there are two wonderful stories that have really inspired me. This weekend, Brian, you know this, we were dealing with a town resident who, in fact, is going through a difficult time. And when we received a report on Monday that individual was at the library, I received an immediate email from the library, the interim library director, saying, you know what, we'll welcome this person with open arms. That's how we build community. I thought that was great. I thought it was a classy response and very appropriate for this community. The other instances when I received the email. The other instances when I received the email that they had negotiated with the school department to drop high school kids at the library. I thought that was brilliant. I thought it was a great service to the community. I really want to commend them for a great job.
They're doing an excellent job. Yeah. They really are. And we're going to have a great library here very soon.
Oh, absolutely.
Going to make the library great again.
Thank you. Yeah. Yes, we are. You can get another hat. Mr. Tedstone, future board agenda items.
Nothing for me.
Mrs. Wright.
Yes, I do have something. A few years ago, actually it was in 2011, the town, the Board of Selectmen and the town and the Chamber of Commerce entered together into this sort of compact called Hopkinton 2020 to promote businesses and work to understand the needs to bring more commerce in. And I think it would be good to try to kind of revitalize that. I was looking back over some of the materials that were entered into back in, 5 years ago, and it seems it's gotten a little more. And there were supposed to be quarterly reports, regular updates from the Chamber to the Board of Selectmen, and annual review, none of which really has happened too much recently. And I know I've been in contact with some small businesses recently feeling that there could be perhaps more ways or more outreach from the town, which speaks right to what 2020 was supposed to be doing. So I would like to see us schedule a time to bring some of the chamber people in to discuss where we're going with this and the kind of updates that we, I don't think, have had in a while.
Correct. We have not had the comprehensive update, but rather we have been working on specific projects that the chamber has reported on regularly. Be that as it may, Elaine, allow me to impose this on you. We secured a grant through the Compact program, and Elaine is the project manager on that project, and I'll let her speak to where the project is. And that in itself will answer the question as to where is this relationship, what are the things that we're working on.
So as part of that grant, Northeastern University has an economic development tool, and it involves starting with a 30 page plus questionnaire about the town. So we have an intern working on getting the answers together for that, and the chamber will also need to be providing answers. So we're working together to fill out that questionnaire. Once we get that in, they will look at our community. They'll come out and they'll have a workshop. So there'll be an economic development activity going on there. So that's something that I think has been contemplated for some time, and it's taken some time to get here, but that's in the works right now.
And part of the overall goal of this project is to help the chamber and the town define the next steps in our relationship.
Well, if I may, through you, Mr. Chairman, I'm glad to hear that. But that was shared because I asked. And, you know, reading back over the community, the 2020, it talked about the charter. The chamber president shall provide quarterly reports to the Board of Selectmen. Board of Selectmen, the town manager in the chamber shall review the relationship with an annual review. Board of Selectmen and the town manager shall meet the chamber on a regular basis. So I think this is the kind of information that should be brought before the town and before the board on a regular basis for these kind of updates as 2020 expected.
So I think it makes
from my understanding.
Go ahead.
Again, to be clear, the 2020 concept was a chamber project. The relationship between the town and the chamber is broader than the 2020 project.
Of course.
But your point is well taken in terms of regular updates. Mm-hmm. We'll go back to that cycle, and the project that I think Elaine is working on will get us there.
I think when individual members get questions from the business community, if we're kept up to date with that kind of reporting, it would help us all to know how to respond to. Thank you.
We can certainly have the chamber come in and explain kind of where they are with 2020, if they're anywhere with 2020,
right.
And then we can kind of go from there. I mean, as they're a separate private organization, and you know they don't answer to us necessarily, but we do have some agreements in place. So
2020
we want to find
was
out.
A partnership.
Right, but if that's dissolved on their side, then it's dissolved on our side too, whether we like it or not. So we'll have to figure that out. But we can certainly talk to them about it. They're great partners in town, and there's a lot going on. My sense is a lot of it went to 26.2, some of that energy for development of other things in town, at least in terms of their side, not our side necessarily. But we can talk about that. We can certainly add it to the agenda. So we'll maybe an update with the chamber at some point soon.
We had a great meeting with the chamber doing the state of the town the other day. We don't want to lose that energy and that rapport that we brought up. People really got a lot out of that.
Yeah. Okay. Future agenda
points.
Items?
Yeah.
Mr. Catino?
Well, I'm going to say parking again. Downtown parking. We got to look at it. We're talking about a new gem opening up across the street that's supposed to bring the community downtown, and we got to find a place to put them.
Yeah. We, for the sports information to clear the point. We are working on parking issues, because the conversations involve private property. When some of these opportunities come up, we're told specifically that these are not for public discussion. Yeah.
I think you combine that with the corridor project that we've been working on and are working on. Maybe it's an update on where we are with the downtown corridor project with a focus on parking would maybe help find some of what's going on. We could do that.
That would help, but I still want to make sure that we're actively looking at parcels that the town can purchase so that we can put some more. Every downtown that's successful has ample parking. Even for our building right here, trying to find a parking space tonight, and when there's a lodge meeting going on next door, Bill's Pizza's trying to do stuff, and then we had a nice audience today. Trying to find a space today was a premium.
Okay. All right. Any other future agenda items? With that, the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn with the understanding we got a bunch of things to sign.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Thank you all. Have a good
Happy
night.
Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving.